and welcome to week two of the English broadcast of the Overwatch Pacific Championship. I'm Avril, and with me tonight is Easy again as we bring you day number three of week two.
I love the way you just said again. Are you a little bit disappointed I'm still here?
I'm glad you're still here.
Okay,
otherwise, it would be just me.
That's what I want to hear. That's what I want to hear right there.
Please, yes, Avril, it's Easy again. Thank you for saving me.
But yeah,
carry me, please.
Very exciting matchups we've got here tonight. First up, we're going to be seeing HKA take on AHQ. And here we see HKA.
默契其实还不够，不需要加强对方就是我们沟通方面的问题啊。不停的练习，就是因为我们时间很短，就是组起来，所以我们要更多的时间去练习，然后打的最好的成绩出来。
现在最大就是应该是刺客者吧，
刺客方面最终会比较高一点，比较能打那些偏单兵的打法。对队伍组合很多元，单坦。 多次阵都是可以掌握的。HKA的参赛目标就是冠军，
当然是夺冠啊，成为世界第一的莱因哈特，这是我很喜欢的工作，我的梦想。HKA
是新的队伍，希望大家多多支持，我们会拿出最好的表现。Hong
Kong Attitude has been one of those teams I've been super super impressed with. They got a pretty tough game tonight though. They're going up against what I feel is going to be probably their main rival in the competition, AHQ. I kind of put HKA inside the top four currently, but this match is going to really determine where they fit within that top four after they face.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to have to agree with you there, and here we see AHQ stepping up to the plate.
This is AHQ's coach, Nito. 不过，因为我们有一些比较老的成员，之前在大陆受训过三四个月，所以不论是基本功或是一些经验，都会比台湾的一般选手来得好。
中国的队伍有很多，有些他们的角色玩得很精专，每张地图有一些很特殊的点位，可以学到一些小技巧。
张达他是一个很强的输出手，曾经跟他当过队友。 可是我觉得我们现在队上的输出其实不会比他弱，
因为队友都很好相处啊，就比较没有困难吧。请大家多多支持我们
HQ Overwatch 战队，关注我的粉丝可以继续为我们团队加油打气。
当然还是拿台湾冠军，因为我觉得我们实战经历比较多，拿下冠军是理所当然。希望其他竞争对手可以加油一点。
I gotta say, Eddie Boss and Cowman, I'm pretty sure they're related. They both have slick as hell haircuts as well.
I mean, to be honest, like, they're no homo, but pretty, you know, swaggerific sort of team there, to be quite frank, you know.
I'm digging really, the jerseys and the jackets too, actually.
They maybe should
really
be like
it out.
AHQ attitude, you know what I'm saying? Like, but it's gonna be interesting to see, you know, who comes out on top there. Is it gonna be the dragon or is it gonna be
the unicorn?
The unicorn.
Oh, you beat me.
The matchup of the mythical animals, it seems.
Oh man, traditionally though, I mean, when you really put it, dragons are pretty fierce. I don't know about unicorns, they feel a bit pansy to me, but at the same time, who knows?
Oh my goodness, the way we're going with these comments here, yeah, I'd put my money on a dragon in a fight there, but you never know, because...
I'd put my money on a dragon sunglasses in particular.
Well, you know,
that's gonna help against Sun Sister, by the way.
Oh, definitely. You know, well, I mean, like the power of the sun, the power of the friendship.
You gotta have the sunnies on against against Sun Sister. Anyway, it's gonna be Hong Kong Attitude versus AHQ before we even get close to Sun Sister. So, this is definitely, I would say, probably the toughest match of the day. Not to say the other matches aren't gonna be this hype, but Hong Kong Attitude versus AHQ. This is what I'm talking about in terms of already slotting these top four teams and where they lie. Now, Blank are safely sitting at the top number one spot. At the same time, Hong Kong Attitude are also undefeated. In fact, they haven't dropped a single map yet. Blank has, so that kind of says something as well. If Hong Kong Attitude sort of go undefeated and continue their undefeated streak, I mean, technically, would that even put Hong Kong Attitude at least map win-wise kind of above Blank?
Well, I mean,
even though they haven't played each other.
It's something you talked about last night, you know, Hong Kong Attitude being one of the only other teams that sort of be running that triple DPS lineup. Mm. And I mean, AHQ obviously got a little taste of the triple DPS medicine yesterday. So they have had a day, I guess, to sort of think about it, go back to the drawing board, and they might have some, you know, some answers for HKA's triple DPS lineup if they choose to run with that.
Yeah, that's interesting as well, because I noticed that triple DPS was probably the biggest weakness for HQ to deal with, and also Flash Wolves on the back of that. Something that HQ and Flash Wolves both struggle to be able to run themselves. I don't think they have a capable third DPS player that I'm sort of aware of at the moment anyway. That being said, HQ got a couple of extra members, but none of those are DPS players. They got Carries, who's another support player. Hong Kong Attitude on the other side. They got Jin Kao, who plays Pharah. They have K4, who plays, you know, Soldier, McCree, Genji, Shailun, who plays Tracer, Genji. They're well and truly ready to go 3 DPS against HQ if they've identified that to be something that HQ struggle against.
I mean, please correct me if I'm wrong here, but I don't think we've seen Kerry's play just yet.
Not yet. We also haven't seen Randy play on Hong Kong Attitude side, but at the same time, Randy is the substitute tank player, and it's very difficult to fill in the shoes of a Ting. I would be kind of concerned if a Ting didn't play, because he's been such a big force and such an impactful player for Hong Kong Attitude.
I mean, it might be interesting to see, you know, if they've actually got Kerry's sort of practicing, you know, some extra DPS roles now. You know, he's listed as support, comes in and he's just got the Pharah of the gods, you know, or like an unbeatable Tracer, or just like the most amazing hit scan you've ever sort of seen.
At this point for HQ, they're almost like, they got two coaches as well. Everyone's like, who plays DPS? Get him in there. Get him in there. We need a third team here.
I think every team after last night's looking around saying, who can play a third DPS? Who can play it well? Somebody do it.
Somebody please.
And I mean, and that was something as
well. Clone Apudo. Someone please clone Apudo. Like,
I mean, I think any team would be happy to have 3 Apudos on there.
Just have 6 Apudos.
Speaking about that, actually, we do have 3 back-to-backs again tonight as well. I think it's going to be AHQ playing back-to-back, then Sun Sister back-to-back, and I think it's Fireball back-to-back after that as well.
Fireball, yeah, you're right. So HQ play Hong Kong Attitude to start things off with it. Then they go on to play Sun Sister. Fireball then go on to take Sun Sister as well. So Sun Sister have 2 back-to-back as the away team. That's going to be really interesting. So similar to what Machi had to deal with yesterday. And then Machi are going to come back for the 4th game against Fireball, this time in the home position. So AHQ are going to be swapping sides between home and away. Sun Sister are going to be on away for the entire day, and Fireball got a back-to-back as well, which will be interesting to see. But one of the other important games is Sun Sister versus Fireball. Now, that's important to sort of determine what that bottom 4 sort of ranking is starting to shape up like. Before we get there, Hong Kong Attitude and HQ, let's just go through the rosters side by side. Now, HKA, we've already sort of talked about the fact that this is a very adaptable lineup, and something I've quite enjoyed watching as well is K4, Shailun and Jin Kao sort of working together.
And on the side of AHQ, obviously Kalman and Dizzy, sort of those DPS players there, but Dizzy definitely being the standout player there. Eric N having a little bit of a struggle over the weekend, probably going to be able to come into his element and hit the ground running in this matchup, I would say.
I think AHQ definitely need to come back really strong after yesterday. I think any team so far to have taken maps off of Blank is a pretty big deal. It does show that they have the capability to beat Blank. I think that's quite important. I think going 0-3 against Blank is definitely not the way you want to go. If you're going to lose to Blank, you want to draw some blood in there. So for HQ, it is a loss, but it is a loss where they can sort of come back and say, we have the capability to win, but now they have to beat Hong Kong Attitude, which is actually a team that's slowly creeping up, and wouldn't really be surprised if Hong Kong Attitude and HQ go the distance in terms of 5 maps.
I mean, I definitely agree with you there. I think they are quite evenly matched. We sort of talked about this before. I think I'm sort of leaning towards the side of HKA just purely on how deep, I guess, their hero pool is, how they can sort of run 2-2-1. They can play triple DPS as well if they want to do that. Also, I think the real thing as well for AHQ, they need to get this win to sort of build that momentum going into Sun Sister. Because when Flash Wolves lost yesterday, and I think it was a little bit to their surprise against Blank, when they played against Machi, it took them a little while to sort of get back into their rhythm and find their groove. You know, Machi actually picked up the first map on control. And I mean, I was quite surprised to see that, you know, coming off Machi's performance last weekend. And they definitely showed that they had a lot of strength to work with. And Flash Wolves, obviously, you know, not coming off that momentum, you know, quite a hard loss against Blank. AHQ definitely need to sort of put themselves in a good position coming up against Sun Sister, because Sun Sister have had another week to practice. We haven't seen them play this weekend yet.
We haven't, yeah.
Maybe they've had leaps and bounds just the same way that sort of Blank did from week 1 to week 2. So maybe they've sort of had some time to practice, you know, had a chat with Detonator as well, you know, and had some scrims and really had a chance to step their game up.
Well, you know, Sun Sister is also going to have a pretty hard game against AHQ as well. HQ are really playing a lot of games this weekend. If I'm not mistaken, it's like 5 games that they're playing. So for HQ, I don't know if they're as shaken up as Flash Wolves would have been. I think Flash Wolves definitely expected a lot more from themselves. And possibly for Blank, they might have even expected a bit more for Flash Wolves as well. So I just sort of noticed that as well. Flash Wolves did look a little bit shaken up. For HQ though, they don't really have time to rest. Flash Wolves, they get the rest of the week off. They don't play at all today. HQ, it's not over. They got two games back to back, and they're hard games too. I mean, Hong Kong Attitude is going to be tough.
And I mean, you were just sort of talking about it just before we had a look at the lineups there. The real big matchup here tonight is going to be Sun Sister coming up against Fireball. Both of these teams currently sitting on zero wins. So obviously after this matchup, someone's going to get themselves their first win, get themselves up on the leaderboard. So a very big matchup for these two teams here.
You were speaking about momentum earlier as well. And momentum going for Hong Kong Attitude is really important because they're on a full win streak. They were kind of where Blank and Flash Wolves were sitting just before yesterday. And for Hong Kong Attitude, they haven't dropped a single map now. Blank have dropped maps, AHQ have dropped maps, Flash Wolves have dropped maps. So technically, this is our last 100% win rate team in the competition.
Yeah, definitely looking to keep that alive coming up against AHQ. And they obviously want to establish that dominance as well, you know, because I think they are going to be having to play Blank next weekend. It's going to be their first matchup. That's the one sort of matchup that Blank haven't... That's still, I guess, a little bit of an issue for them, maybe a little bit of a worry for them coming into next weekend. So they are definitely going to be wanting to establish themselves, you know, as a strong team, showing the strength and the depth of their lineup as well before they have to play, you know, the likes of Blank next weekend.
Yeah, that's going to be an even tougher game for Hong Kong Attitude, but they've got some way to go. They've still got a full day's worth of games to go. Our first map is going to be Lee Jung Tower, picked by Hong Kong Attitude in the home position. So we've seen a decent amount of Lee Jung Tower already. Haven't seen a single Ilios yet, seen one Nepal that was picked by AHQ, so Hong Kong Attitude probably watched their game yesterday, have dodged Nepal. Not that AHQ had an astoundingly great performance on Nepal, but Hong Kong Attitude, I think they've played a decent amount of Lee Jung Tower now that we've seen, and they've looked pretty good on there, and it definitely sort of works out towards their favour in terms of getting that 3 DPS lineup in there as well.
I think the real issue though here is going to be how Hong Kong Attitude sort of deal with Dizzy. Because that was sort of the one issue that Blank ran into there as well. It's purely, they were just so surprised with how individually and I guess mechanically skilled Dizzy is as a player. And that if he can sort of start turning up, he can really turn the tide in this one, I feel.
Yeah, I think Dizzy and Calman are still a force to be reckoned with. But, you know, for Hong Kong Attitude, the way you deal with Dizzy and the way that Blank dealt with Dizzy was you sort of corner the guy, you back the guy into a corner, and you have so many multiple different threats from different angles that for one guy, he can probably snipe out. He can use a McCree, and he can snipe out, eat up on Tracer. He can probably kill Shaolin on Tracer, right? But for K4 and Jin Kao still roaming around on the other side, that's still going to be very, very difficult for him to deal with.
And I guess that comes back into that whole strength of that triple DPS lineup, you know. You can't do much if you're just that single DPS left alive if the rest of your team is just dead and stuck in the old spawn. So if they do manage to get that running and manage to sort of take out, I guess, the rest of his supporting cast, you know, Dizzy sort of gets left alone by himself. And that's where the issues, I guess, you know, AHQ sort of run into there.
Yeah, well, the gates are about to open. HK on the blue side, AHQ on the right. And the first stage is going to be Control Center. And it will be a double DPS lineup, a 2-2-2 lineup for Hong Kong Attitude. A triple tank lineup for AHQ as the first charge moves in.
And see Dizzy on that McCree there as well, so pay attention to him. He just absolutely destroys Shio, just as you mentioned. But it's going to be K4 getting right back in there for the side of HKA right now. Looking to find some return trades right there. It's 2-2, so 4v4 left here on the point. And it's looking like AHQ wanting to push in. But the first cap, it's going to be HKA slowly pushing their way onto it, getting a little bit of time here. But AHQ, as I mentioned, pushing their way onto the point, getting themselves the first cap most likely here, but K4 not letting them have a bar of it. The counterattack comes back out again from HKA, not letting them get anything here. They need to get somebody on the point though. They need to cap this one over.
AHK would be a pretty fearsome team. What is it, like the combined strength of both teams at the same time? I mean,
you got me.
Blank should be scared of that one. Either way, Hong Kong Attitude are going to manage to get the first cap out. AHQ looked like they had the ground, they looked like they had the positioning. But as soon as the Hong Kong Attitude plays in the respawn, K4 is one of the big factors. Before we get there, Jing already gets charged back. There goes a nano boost inside the Hong Kong Attitude. K4 going nuts inside the base. Dizzy already going down, but time's running out for him. He did get fire grenade as well, so he has to back out. A Ting going to get this hammer down on quite a few of the AHQ members. Just going to hold them back in their spawn for the time being. 29%. still a decent amount of time left to go.
I mean, good stuff from AHQ there, you know, not having too much to work with for themselves. A lot of ultimates being committed there from the side of HKA, and great counterplay there, you know, the biotic grenade, the sleep
dart, gone,
stopping them there in their tracks. Kalman going to be charged up, but it doesn't matter when the rest of his team is just getting walked over right now. The sound barrier coming up from CQB there, and that's all that HKA had to use in that fight to take it to AHQ and keep them back in the spawn. Look at the spawn camp now coming out from HKA continuously. AHQ need to find something soon, because as HKA passed 54% now, things are getting dire.
There's not a lot HQ got ready to use here. They really need to get another Graviton Surge. There goes the Earthshadow, only catches Crappy, and a Graviton Surge catching up all the HQ members as well. Hong Kong Attitude need a couple more kills, but they have broken out of this base hold just ever so slightly. Dizzy's still left inside the base. Cowman is fighting for his life on the sides. Pulse Bomb will clean up Dizzy, but it's actually very, very even trades, and HQ managed to break out.
But that's exactly what HKA are looking for. That's all they need right now. Lazy Titan actually going to be getting in onto Jin Kao, cleaning up CQB there as well. This is going to be AHQ's moment to recap here, not letting HKA get up into the 90%. So they managed to get in just in the nick of time. And now let's see if they go for an aggressive position here. Eric going to be stuck over here on the left side by himself. Looks like HKA going to have a little bit of space to work with here, managed to get themselves through the choke point quite easily. We'll have that nano boost there on Mango to work with, and the blade on K4, so watch out for that nano blade combo coming through up in the back lines. That should be all that they need, actually, because AHQ have nothing to counterplay with them, and Kalman can get this Graviton Surge up, and there it is. Crappy falls down very quickly. Dizzy's gone as well. Eddie Boss is taken out as well. K4 just slicing through the entire side here, not worried about anything. Kalman going to be there to drop as well. HKA looking like they're going to get this point back off AHQ before they even get 40%.
Two ultimates is all they needed. K4 got a lot more distance with that nano blade than he did previously. Really got locked out the other time, but this time he found all the squishies on the back line, activated and jumped straight in. The Shaolin's gonna watch out for herself just ever so slightly though. HQ gonna come in with a bit of a Deadeye play here, but they're gonna need a lot more. 99% Earth Shadow does connect. Dizzy goes down, and it is all falling apart for AHQ. Lazy Titan and Eric in on the front lines, but they're struggling to attack any sort of targets. It's self-destruct, does pick up Shaolin, so little signs of life now for AHQ coming back into this, but a Ting cleans up Kalman. Three members left alive for AHQ. It's going to be Crappy, still trying to get the damage done, but there's only supports and tanks left. Hong Kong Attitude should be able to clean this one up as Dizzy makes his way back onto the point, but it might be a little bit too late.
I think Lazy Titan actually managed to eat himself a Graviton Surge there as well, and they didn't even really need it. Once it was taken, they still managed to win the fight out here as well. Deadeye not finding too much with that one.
Got reflected
as well,
actually.
Gets reflected by K4. And now it's just going to be Kalman trying to keep the hopes alive of AHQ. Eddie Boss shouldn't be able to make this back. The Dragon Blade comes out from K4 to close it out. There we have the map one, HKA looking dominant.
Looked really good. They had the early control. They had the early sort of spawn camping advantage, and they made it really difficult for HQ to sort of get themselves out of there. They had to nano boost Kalman on the Zaya to actually attempt to push out, but what a difficult hold to get out of, and that sort of open space area really worked towards Hong Kong Attitude's favor in terms of the fact that they were running Genji and Tracer, K4 and Shaolin really running around Dizzy. And even though they don't have three DPS, even with just those two, I felt like Dizzy did have a bit of a hard time trying to track them down. He eventually did kill Shaolin, but his front line was getting melted as well. Jun Kao was definitely there doing a great job.
And I think this is just what we talked about as well before this match went live. You know, it's so hard when the rest of your team are just getting destroyed, but we're right out into this one. Jun Kao going to be on the Pharah, Mango going to be up on the Zenyatta here, K4 sticking on the Genji, and now it's going to be Kalman on the Genji himself on the side of AHQ. They've got Eric now on the Winston. See how this one works out for them. Mango, they're landing a Discord orb, but he's getting taken out from behind right there. Genji manages to take him out there. Jin Kao finding himself with a kill onto Dizzy, so AHQ do lose their big DPS player, but a lot of this is going to fall now onto Kalman, but he's dropping extremely quickly. Jin Kao controlling the point right now, but there's a lot of pressure on him inside. Doesn't have much support to work with. 2 HP, trying to keep himself up, but he can't right now. AHQ looking dominant in this first fight.
That's a difficult place for a Pharah to be. I mean, for Jin Kao, you really want to be able to secure the outside area. The other difficult thing is Hong Kong Attitude. Now we're actually running a Mercy here. So for Jin Kao, not getting too much support. It's very difficult to be playing Pharah sort of in this situation. In HQ, good early play with the tanks. I mean, I felt like as soon as they got inside the actual control center itself, they alleviated the pressure of that triple DPS quite a bit. And I felt like Mango Jai had a lot of pressure on him as well.
And I also want to mention there as well, you know, he sort of got in there a little bit too soon without the front line to sort of help him out on the point. Jin Kao was just easily thwarted, you know, by even just the support characters that were just hanging around on the point, getting the cap there for AHQ. A team jumping in there, Mango Jai falling down up in the back lines as well. So two players again down for the side of HKA. They do manage to find themselves a couple of trades here. Nano Boost coming in now on Eric N, managing to get a lot done with that. Just a little bit of chip damage, just pressuring out some of these squishier characters. And look at this Jin Kao, not getting much room to work with at all. Takes himself down a mech, but I mean, is it enough right now for HKA to push in? There comes the barrage coming through, finds one with that, can't find a second, gets taken out by Kalman there, and HKA players are dropping that sound barrier on AHQ, keeping them alive.
Let's see what K4 can get done with his Dragonblade if he decides to use it. Going to go for the suicide instead. Hong Kong Attitude losing yet another fight and yet finding it very difficult to be able to break through for AHQ. Already on 61%. Ultimates now coming online big time for AHQ. Looking like four Cowmen and Lazy Tide now charged up as well. They've only got K4 the Dragonblade on the Hong Kong Attitude side, and they're still stuck in base. Still waiting to just get over that bridge. Here comes the initial jump by a Ting. The rest of his teammates kind of slow to back him up though.
Primal Rage ready here as well on a Ting, jumping right up into the back line. Good sleep dart actually. Oh, almost managing to take him out. Looking to get some environmental kills there. Doesn't manage to get anything. Eddie Boss getting knocked up against the wall, making him waste so much time with that Biotic Grenade now. Going to be able to keep himself alive for a little bit longer. But HKA cleaning up the line here of AHQ, managing to get themselves back into this one. Not even using too many ultimates for that one. Only the Primal Rage has been committed for this. So this is going to be their moment to turn this game around and answer back.
Yeah, we've been to the overtime crappy, just kind of suicides his life a little bit there. Gave that one away a little bit too quickly, I think. Most of the ultimates now up online for Hong Kong Attitude. They've got a long way to go. They've got so much time to make up and not a lot to work with, because AHQ still managed to hold on to a decent number of ultimates, and they just have to sort of work their way in here. Jin Kao does need to be dealt with. Felt like Jin Kao did do a decent amount of damage there.
Oh, and look at this. It's going to be Shio jumping straight onto Eddie. He's actually been split up from the rest of his team. He's easily dealt with now from the side of HKA. It's going to be Mango Jai hitting the Transcendence up on the main point there. So they do commit one small ultimate for that one there. Not sure if it was used to the best of its ability, but winning the fight is still winning the fight.
35%, still got a fair way to go, but they've got Hong Kong Attitude are making the best of the situation. Jin Kao's actually, he's able to get all of these kills, sort of all these opening kills, really softening up the AHQ side. But here comes the big commitment to Nanoblade, a self-destruct to open things up. CQB goes down extremely early. A Cowman looking at a Ting who goes down to a pulse bomb by Dizzy as well. So this is going to be AHQ getting the cleanup. Only one member left. CQB respawns. Is Shylin the only person left? He won't last much longer. AHQ going to get this cap and straight into the overtime.
But can they get back onto the point? Can they touch us right now? They're running out of time. They need to jump into this run right now. A Ting manages to keep it alive for the rest of HKA, but they need to back him up very soon because he gets absolutely melted on the point by himself. The players are now trickling in. AHQ should be able to hold this one quite simply as they pick off the players one by one here. And that is exactly what's happening. Shio managing to find that kill up onto Eddie Boss. A little bit of hope left alive here for HKA. K4 gets dropped down there as well. Jin Kao did have the barrage ready, but didn't manage to get it off in time. Now a Ting rushing back to the point as well, keeping this one alive yet again. Mango Jai switching up to the soldier. Looking to sprint in, but he cannot get it. AHQ equalize here.
Yeah, well played by AHQ. They just needed to... They had a really great start. I feel like Hong Kong Attitude struggled to get themselves any sort of fight. It was about 60% before Hong Kong Attitude got their first fight win, I believe. And HQ, they sort of played that quite patiently. They understood when they needed to come in. Didn't really struggle against the third DPS there. I feel like Jin Kao had a couple of moments, but otherwise, HQ didn't really seem that fazed by it.
I mean, from what we saw as well there, it looked like the Pharah really wasn't doing a lot of work up in the air there. Couple of rockets, you know, being hit, you know, finding a kill, but getting almost traded instantly, you know, never sort of getting the two kills for one, which he was sort of looking for.
I think that's the difficulty of running a Pharah without the Mercy combo. We had Mango on the Zenyatta for quite a long time, and just unable to sustain himself properly on the Pharah. But we're going to go into Night Market anyway. Early jump in by Eric Kent to set the stage, and HQ got great positioning to start things off.
Oh, they find K4 the kill.
Already takes on Eric Kent though, so they're starting to pay for a little bit of trades going on the other side. But for the most part, Hong Kong Attitude are kind of stuck in their base. They have to sort of get out of gear, eventually getting the damage in there, and now it's HQ, the ones that are falling apart.
They fall into the trap though from Hong Kong Attitude, and they managed to find all the kills here now as well. Should be able to get themselves this first cap quite simply there. When it looked like AHQ had the better positioning, sort of managed to catch out a couple of these AHQ players. The flank from HKA, far too smart and far too I suppose, left, right, and centre for AHQ to deal with.
Well, the unfortunate thing for AHQ is, although they had the early jump and they had the early pressure, they couldn't actually secure any of those early kills. That really kind of cost them. They got the one kill, but lost Eric pretty much straight away as well. As soon as Winston went down, that's when the team really started to fall.
Well, I guess the adaptation here from HKA, Jin Kao on the Zarya, getting a lot more work done with this one. Kalman getting up into the back lines now as well, looking to take out Mango. He will drop instantly, absolutely melted here, but HKA answer back with a couple of their own there. Does he find that pulse bomb onto a tank? Kalman trying to chase down up in the back lines here. CQB doing a good job to keep himself elusive up on the walls there, but without the rest of his team now, Shayu going to be the last one left here to keep this one up for them. He does manage to find the pulse bomb actually onto Crappy there. Kalman finally manages to find CQB up at the back here. Does have the Dragon Blade up to work with now as well. Cap extremely close for the side of
AHQ.
Gonna
have to use this.
Dragon Blade's going to have to come in indeed. He manages to find one here, looking to jump onto the Winston and the Tracer. Get anything at all. Eat some lightning for dinner.
And Ting's going to keep on going. He's got the Primal Rage as well. Just keeping this one alive for Hong Kong Attitude. They're getting so much progress meter off this. And still struggling to kill a Ting. He's doing such a great job of storing this one out. HQ finally get it in there. And now Hong Kong Attitude going to be up to back off. Going to have to back off. But at 66%, felt like the mileage they got off that was definitely worth it.
Yeah, Ting almost actually managing to escape with his life there as well. They do have this Graviton Surge to work with as well. But not only that, the Nano Boost Sound Barrier and the Dragon Blade as well. Pulse Bomb going to be up on Shayu in just a second as well. So a lot of ultimates to work with here on the side of AHQ, but the counterplay coming in from AHQ, definitely there to work with Sound Barrier of their own. Nano Boost as well. Lazy Titan going to be dropping the self-destruct, but K4 with the sword out, looking to find something. Hitting that Nano Blade of Winston though might not be the target he's looking for up in the front. Good protection there coming out from Eric.
Let's see what Jin Kao can do with this one. Still a Graviton ready to go. He's going to make sure it doesn't get eaten up though. Lazy Titan's got his eyes on Jin Kao very tightly. They're all on this sort of right side flank section. The Graviton finally does go down. HKA cleaning up the kills on the side, getting the cap back. HQ gonna have to come in very quickly on this one. Not a lot of time left to contest.
I mean, once Jin Kao got completely charged up there, it was gonna be very easy for them to sort of deal with that overcommitment there from AHQ. I feel that the Graviton Surge was probably not needed there, but I mean, better to be safe than sorry. Now a Ting in this great position here, managing to catch a lot of these players as they try to back up Dizzy up on the point here. He's going to be doing a lot of this hero play work by himself, and now he's getting hunted down right now with a Ting. If he does a quick turn, he could have got him there, but Shy will be there to clean that one up there. Now Kalman though, again hunting Mango. This seems to be his favorite fruit indeed. Does manage to not find the kill and get paid with it with his life indeed. Lazy Titan dropping down now as well. HKA looking very dominant, coming up past 95%. Got the Dragon Blade as well, Primal Rage and the Nano Boost to work with. HKA answer back very strongly here on number three and lead the series 2-1.
2-1, it's actually been fairly close. They've just been trading maps here and there. And even within all of these Lijiang maps so far, both teams have had a really good shot at taking punches at the other side. And I mean, aside from Control Center, which I believe was definitely more favored for the Hong Kong Attitude side, when we look at Gardens, when we look at Night Markets, those two have seriously gone back and forth quite heavily.
Most definitely. It's really hard to sort of talk about, I mean, which one of these teams is looking more dominant at the moment. They're both having, I guess, equally dominant performances. You know, they really get that early advantage and know how to sort of keep themselves in control of the entire matchup there. And the other thing to note as well is that HKA, you know, when they're hot, they're hot. And it's the same with AHQ. They can't really find an answer once they sort of lose that early advantage. We're coming into map number four now. Jin Kao going back onto the Pharah, but this time he's got a Mercy to have his back.
Oh, Mango's definitely swapped that one up and realized there was probably a mistake. A very early jump in by Eric as well. Both bubbles down on both sides, and the fight is starting to move within the actual control point itself. Meanwhile, Jin Kao's going to be looking for assassinations on the side, finds Crappy. Eric N also followed earlier than that. No real trades coming out of AHQ. K4 does go down, but I don't think it's really going to be enough at this stage. And Kalman himself is even a little bit stuck inside the nearby house.
Oh, HKA find the answer here on map number four. Answer back very strongly this time, looking to get themselves a dominant start yet again. And you've got to be careful because, as we've mentioned before, once you get that early advantage, these teams are so good at running with it, holding onto it, knowing when they can lose the fight, and can obviously continue and push back with that advantage that they've got here. Mango getting very close to the Resurrect as well. Looking like Shy is going to have that Pulse Bomb up extremely quickly. Faster than Dizzy, that's for sure. Kalman switching up to the Soldier now, looking to deal with Jin Kao up in the air.
Thanks.
But let's see if he can actually get it done, because obviously Jin Kao with the Mercy behind him got a lot of damage to work with here. Is he going to be moving in up in the back lines? Eric going to be jumping in, trying to find some of these squishier characters, but great hold out here from HKA.
Yeah, you know, Cowman's down already, so identifying the only real threat on the other team that can deal with Jin Kao is shuts some dumps straight away is extremely good, and now HQ is really struggling to be able to find any further ways in here. Dizzy finally managed to get Mango Jai, so the healing nullified for Jin Kao, but I don't think it's going to be enough to really secure this point. I could be wrong, because there comes the Pulse Bomb, doesn't manage to land himself any kills, and now Dizzy in a little bit of trouble, might chase down K4, but unable to really lock down a single target. There goes Jin Kao.
I mean, we've seen Dizzy do these hero plays before, and he is doing work right now here on the point. Absolutely taking it to HKA. Resurrection comes in now as well. A lot of these HKA members back here as well. Dizzy going to have to start all over again and work them all down all over. And this is absolutely insane plays here coming out from Dizzy, though, keeping himself going all on his lonesome here for the side of AHQ, and it doesn't look like they still have found an answer for him. He's still going to work indeed. He's almost got himself another Pulse Bomb. He's looking to take out Mango here as well. Pulse Bomb going to be up here. Oh, finally gets taken down by the Blade of K4.
Now that was a very long and interesting run by Dizzy, and his team was sort of filtering in there as well. He just managed to stay alive. We sort of saw him do this on Nepal against Blank as well, but they're running out of time. 96% for Hong Kong Attitude. They're really dominating this Gardens map. They kind of struggled on it the last time around. There goes CQB with the Shockwave. Will survive a direct Pulse Bomb blast, and now Dizzy, the hero, can he get any work done, because this is so much pressure.
And now it's going to be Shai who actually is looking to pressure Arnor himself, but finds a Crappy instead, takes out the Lucio, just skating on top of that Pulse Bomb. Very unlucky there for the side of AHQ. They're losing players now. It doesn't look very good for them as the overtime starts ticking down. Now Shai, being the tracer that's in control, cleans it up. HKA take map number one, 3-1.
Always disappointing when you find a Crappy. I mean,
when you least expect it, there's a Crappy.
It's not what you want on Christmas morning. A4, man of the match. Feel like you almost want to give it back to Dizzy, and Dizzy did such a great job with Tracer once again. This would have been that very first control center map that we saw. Wow, just the ability for K4, and I want to put Shayu Lin in there as well, the sort of 1-2 punch combo of they work together in a way where they're not in the same sort of space where you can necessarily shut them both down at the same time, but they're always able to focus down sort of similar targets there. And K4's a great player that's able to sort of play for the objective and understand where the damage needs to be, just like you sort of saw there.
And I guess the adaptation, you know, coming out from the side of HKA, just while we're sort of on the, you know, HKA bandwagon here, you know, looking very dominant there on control, the way that they sort of they lose some of these fights and they sort of change it up. You know, Jin Kao making that change to Zarya there. I mean, perfect stuff, you know. And then when they go back to using the Pharah, they run the Pharmacy combo there. Works out so much better.
Yeah,
for
that's
them.
Exactly what they needed. They needed to do that the first time around on Gardens. You saw a big, big difference for what Jin Kao really could have done. And it's not so much Jin Kao's own ability at that stage. It's sort of play styles even. You feel a lot safer with the Mercy behind you. You know that you can survive so much more damage. And it requires a much harder counter now against a solo Pharah. You can sort of soft counter it. You don't really require the McCree or the Soldier direct counter. You can have guys on the ground, you know, even a Genji and a Tracer at that sort of stage. You can just sort of pepper in enough damage that forces the Pharah to just fly away for a bit. Now, when they've got a Mercy behind them, you can't do the same thing. Not only that, but then there's a damage boost as well. So that's when Pharahs really start to get out of control. Yeah, you go from 100 to 0. Sorry, you go from a Gardens map that you lose to then 100 zeroing, and the only difference you really made is swap the Zenyatta for a Mercy. I mean, that's a big change-up that they should have done earlier.
I mean, and we've sort of talked about, I guess, these two tank players, you know, Eric and Ating, you know, quite standout players here. Who do you think Winston, I guess, was getting the peanut butter in this game? You know, who was really getting it done out of these two?
I think they were both getting it done, but the difference is Eric N did get shut down fairly early. In fact, Ating got shut down quite a few times as well. So both teams did a pretty good job of eliminating the Winston threat from either side. But in terms of pure mileage, I feel like when Ating was able to get into the other team, Hong Kong Attitude were able to get so much more out of that, whereas I feel like for AHQ, when Eric was the one going in, he would sort of open up the plays for his team, but it was a bit more difficult for AHQ, from my understanding, from my observation, really, to be able to take advantage of the space created by Eric in.
Yeah, I really felt Ting actually did a lot of good job at staggering a lot of the points as well. Same with sort of Shayu in those situations. And it comes down to the side of AHQ. They're dizzy, sort of left alone a lot of the time. And this is something we talked about before coming into this first map. You know, if the rest of the team's dead, you know, Dizzy's sort of left by himself there. It seems to be a common occurrence now on the side of AHQ, you know, when they run into these teams who sort of know how to deal with them. You know, they don't worry about Dizzy too often. You know, he's not their first target. They sort of deal with the rest of the team and then try to track him down.
And that sometimes works out for you. Other times it means Dizzy just goes on a complete killing spree. Double pulse bombs, you name it. So on some level, you have to be able to shut down Dizzy. On another level, it's easier said than done. I mean, you got to try and chase down this Tracer that is incredibly hard to kill. I mean, we saw towards the end there in Gardens, Dizzy by himself, barely any teammates around him, and he's still contesting the cap as a solo Tracer. Gets a second pulse bomb, just dies before he sort of manages to get in there. But pulling a lot of weight for his team, I feel.
I guess that's why that pharmacy, you know, sort of works out so well. You know, you land that direct rocket onto a slippery little Tracer, and then it's goodbye, it's good night, good to see you later, mate. It makes it, I guess, a lot easier, you know, rather than...
It really chunks him out, it really forces him to, again, it's...
You know, the Genji can just slice him and dice him.
It's about the sort of damage pressure you put on other players. So if, without Pharah raining rockets down, especially 50%, or not even 50%, but, you know, damage boosted rockets down, and you... if you're a Tracer player, you can play quite aggressively when you're on that 150 health. You can play quite aggressively when you know your tanks are alive to back you up, when you know you've got access to health pack and access to healing. It's when you start to sort of lose teammates, get chunked out on damage, then you have to play quite defensively, then you have to back out, or put yourself in a suicide situation where you're very likely to get killed quite quickly.
And something else to sort of note there as well is that Crappy, I feel, is somewhat a passive player on the Lucio. I think he's sometimes not doing as much as he could be compared to, I guess, some of the other Lucios we've sort of seen. And, you know, Lucio moving into the new meta, something I sort of talked about last night about how Lucio's going to probably be a big DPS hero. Not actually, but, I mean, I've seen some good clips out there on the internet. You know, tweet at me, actually, if you've got some crazy Lucio DPS plays.
The best patch ever for DPS, thank you. I mean, he's... He's having a lot of fun with this one.
I can imagine. So, you know, I've just seen... he's so quick, you can't deal with him. That's besides the point. That's a new patch. We're not talking about that just yet. But I feel that...
Next week.
If Crappy could sort of get in there a little bit more and help add some pressure onto the side of HKA, that's what they're sort of looking for, and that's going to really, really help them.
At the same time, you really need to be able to focus on that healing zone. You need to be focused on the speed boost and the support for your team. You're really fulfilling your support role and sort of adding in damage and adding in utility where you can. And... if anything else, just sort of be extremely annoying. It's the kind of stuff that RQT did as Lucio for Blank yesterday as well. Just sort of wall riding around the inner spiral section of Gardens on Lijiang as well. Just doing things on Lucio to sort of be extremely frustrating to deal with. Just be this really slippery frog that the enemy team just can't grip it.
Shout out to Frogger if he's watching there. But seriously, though, what I'm sort of, I guess, getting at there is CQB looks like he's doing a lot more on the Lucio in regards to, he's still supporting his team, but he's really getting in there, you know, landing a lot of his shots, you know, and really helping them sort of finish off some of the, I guess, like the very low HP, you know, characters on the side of AHQ.
I think they're both fairly invisible on both sides, though. You're seeing the Annas come out a little bit more with the bio grenades in particular, but both the Lucios in this team, on these two teams, are a little bit more invisible. And that's like, I sort of spoke to this last week, and that's kind of okay as well. As long as they're getting the healing done, as long as they're getting the speed boosts at the correct times, and utility is there, and they're just being annoying to deal with. And they're able to sort of stall out time and essentially be doing almost what Dizzy was doing, is just contesting the caps, playing on the objectives, and able to buy your team a lot of time. That's kind of what looks like good play.
I just want a Lucio play of the game. It's all I want. I just want it.
Yeah, you'd have to get like a triple environmental boop or something like that.
And more. A sound barrier and super healing. But it looks like our next map's going to be the one, the only King's Row.
Yeah, King's Row, everyone's favorite hybrid. Definitely OPC's favorite hybrid. Everyone likes to go for King's Row. So that's going to be Hong Kong Attitude's pick. No, it's not. It's going to be AHQ's pick, actually. That's going to be interesting as well. I believe yesterday AHQ didn't get the pick, so Blank picked Numbani against AHQ. It'll be interesting to see what AHQ would have picked against Blank. I have a feeling that King's Row might have been on the cards, but we'll have to see. King's Row definitely the most popular hybrid of the OPC so far.
I mean, this might play into obviously the strengths of AHQ a little bit more here. I think this is where they can sort of, you know, have that standard defense. We'll obviously see if they are going to defend or attack first, but they can sort of have that structured team fight, which it looks like they do a lot better with. You know, being able to sort of protect Izzy, know exactly where he is, and once they can sort of work around him a little bit more, because, you know, when it's control, you know, and the fights are a little bit more frantic and they're breaking out left, right, and center, it's hard for you to sort of keep track of Dizzy, you know, when Dizzy probably calls to be, hey, can someone help me out here a little bit? There's something else happening which is stopping that player from assisting him. Whereas in this, you know, with that structured defense, I think this works out really well for AHQ, and this is where they're really going to be able to shine.
I think we're going to see a little bit more Dizzy on the McCree, and that's something I look forward to as well. This is going to be more of a standard composition for Hong Kong Attitude as well. I'm expecting K4 to probably be on either Genji or Soldier, but more likely to be on Soldier. If anyone's going to be on Genji, I'm expecting Shaolin to maybe pick up the Genji for this one. So, yeah, it's just sort of standard picks all around. I'm not expecting Jin Kao to pull the Pharaoh out on this one. I'm not expecting any sort of pharmacy plays either. Jin Kao, put him on the Zaya. Keep a Ting on the Reinhardt. This is the sort of core composition that Hong Kong Attitude have practiced a lot. They're really good at that.
What if we see that surprise Orisa, you know? Every now and again, you know, we get to see the four-legged machine of Doom come out and eat some rockets.
Well, only if it's Flash Wolves against Blank, I think.
I was picked a couple of times in weekend number one.
Yeah, actually, surprisingly on King's Row, first checkpoint.
I think some teams have some pocket strats.
That is where it kind of came out, so.
I'm really looking forward to seeing that, you know. I think as, obviously, we move forward, I think the Orisa strats, you know, around that sort of little mini Graviton surge, I think that's really what teams are sort of looking for there. It really helps them. I think it's when they sort of push back around behind the corner. You know, you can pull them together if you shoot it through the hotel, and then you can jump in and, like, obviously get a lot of AoE done. What do you reckon?
Possibly. I don't know. I don't think I've played enough Orisa to really tell you that. I don't think I've seen enough Orisa in high competitive games either to sort of give you any insight on that one.
Where's the doctor when you need him?
Sleep. I don't know. Working in the hospital. Eating peanuts. Who knows? There it is, King's Row.
We're going to get right up into this one. Shaolin actually going with the hog there, I like that.
Well, it's going to be HQ on the attack first, so I believe it is their pick, sorry, so they chose to be on attack first.
Dizzy actually
triple tank as well, so we're Dizzy on the Soldier, so a pretty safe pick. I was almost expecting the McCree to come back up, but the Soldier sort of works just fine here as well.
We didn't see too much of that yesterday, actually, Dizzy on the Soldier. Something he doesn't
really
often go
through. That's a big flank from Dizzy, actually.
They're right up in there. Now, Dizzy with the high ground advantage up here, going to be able to get a lot of damage done up here. Trying to look for some frags. Can't find too much just yet. Eric N dropping very low. Manages to keep himself alive. Lazy Titan almost losing his mech there as well. But Kalman's going to open it up for the side of AHQ as they try to lead into this one. But HKA, they're going to be answering back now. They're going to be looking to push this one back. It's going to be Jin Kao charged up immensely right now, being able to do a lot of damage to the side of AHQ. And as you can see, the power of the Zarya right now just pushing them back, getting it all done. Crappy going to be falling there as well.
Dizzy's
still up here, though.
He's unfortunately just stuck. If he can get a kill onto K4, that'll be a really big deal. But it's not going to look like he's got support from Lucio as well. So it's going to be the combination of CQB and K4 eventually pushing him out. It was a good flank from Dizzy going up around the clock tower side, forcing K4 down to start with. But then the rest of AHQ couldn't really secure that sort of bottom team fight to really win it. Now they're trying for round number two. A lot of ultimates coming online as well.
Well, the bonus for them, they do have that Nano Visor to work with and an Earth Shatter as well. So, I mean, if they time these perfectly, they can still win this fight. Here comes a Graviton Surge coming through, manages to pick up a lot of these AHQ members. Nice counterplay coming out there, but that Biotic Grenade going to be stopping a lot of the healing coming through. But it doesn't matter right now when you don't have that damage and you can't even drop them low at all. Now, let's see how AHQ manage that counterplay. Big Graviton into Biotic Grenade into Self Destruct, picks up four. Unbelievable stuff there from AHQ. Going to be pushing out HKA very simply onto the payload now.
That's exactly the kind of combination play that they needed to get back in there. Earth Shatters from both sides as well, like barely connecting, but the grav self-destruct play, that's all they really needed. Erican punishing K4 for the aggressive plays as well. Good sleep dart from Eddie Boss to get that one in there.
Look at this, when you've got a Reinhardt all the way up here onto past checkpoint two now, flexing on this corner. HKA are going to need to find some answer to push him back here. He's also got support as well. Dizzy got control of the high ground. This is the issue now for HKA. They don't even have this high ground.
AHQ are getting so much time now, pushing the cart up. It's just going to be Lucio back there, just pushing it up slowly. Kalman still extremely charged up. Shiyu trying to contest the high ground now as well. Jinkao charging out here as well. But Kalman's going to get a lot of work done here. K4 finds the kill onto Eric.
It is K4 starting to do a little bit of work here. HQ, they only had four members up there. Crappy was still pushing the cart, mind you. So Honking Attitude getting the punish back in there. Jinkao this time with a high charge on Zaya as well. Getting the ground back, and Crappy unfortunately didn't really get the cart up enough for AHQ, so this is still a very contestable defense for Hong Kong Attitude. They still have the bookstore corner to work with, which is a really important stage to be able to defend.
I really thought that Crappy would have been able to get a lot more push done there, but Hong Kong Attitude not wasting any time on that counter-attack, and AHQ not wasting any time with their own, charging straight, and Nano Boost going to be up on the Reinhardt in the front line. The grab comes through, but look at that Biotic Grenade on the team, keeping them all alive. They don't manage to find any damage onto the side of AHQ, but Crappy, he is the one to fall down there. Kalman does have that Graviton of his own to work with, Dizzy trying to get back in here. He is going to manage to get himself away with 20 HP left on here.
Counter-tactical
visor cleaning up the rest of this fight now, and Dizzy somehow keeping himself alive through all of that AoE damage there, and cleans it up there for the side of AHQ.
Oh, this is going to be HQ now pushing through. Hong Kong Attitude, members still respawning here, all five of them. There was a big team wipe coming up for HQ. Did have to use a bunch of ults, so Eric is going to have to look for a pretty decent Earth Shatter, but for a team, he hasn't really gotten that much mileage out of these Earth Shatters so far. Got the self-destruct coming online for Shaolin as well, so still running with that triple DPS. This is going to look for the kill on K4, manages to get there on Kalman, takes down Jin Kao as well. It's the battle of the cattles, I think. Eriken taking down a Tang, and it's going to be AHQ pushing on through, still with Crappy on the back line, getting that card up, 87 charge for Kalman as well. It's quite a lot to deal with, and HQ so much pressure, so much mileage to getting out of that one push.
I love the aggressiveness here coming out from AHQ, answering back with vengeance here. Now look at this patience here as well. They are just destroying K4. They are all over him. It's definitely not K4 for real today. Getting taken out here. Graviton Surge now coming in onto the side of HKA. Good Biotic Grenade there as well. Self-destruct to clean up that one there. Counter self-destruct. Probably won't find anything with that one, but where's the payload? It's coming down now. They need to get back onto this point, HKA. Can K4 manage to get himself out of spawn and get some work done now on this Genji? Soldier not working out too well for
Nano
him.
Boost,
and look at this, the payload coming straight through right now. There comes that sound barrier. Nano Boost here onto a Ting. Needs to swing that hammer around, but Eric's still holding that Earth Shatter there himself, and they are just getting destroyed right now by Dizzy with that tactical visor. It's going to be Lazy Titan picking up a few more there as well. AHQ, very convincing push here.
And Earth Shatter just right at the end to just secure it for AHQ, but they had a couple of really important fights here. The big one at the start, getting the quad self-destruct with the Graviton, and then moving through that sort of middle section as well. A lot of these grabs coming online, that's really been very effective for HQ. All the grabs have been what's kind of setting up the big plays and setting up the wins. But for Hong Kong Attitude, I'm really surprised Shaolin so far hasn't managed to really prevent these Gravitons from happening.
Yeah, there's that as well. You know, a lot of these Gravitons, we've seen them already be eaten. I mean, I think there's already been one or two eaten in this, in that first sort of control matchup alone. Might have just been the one there. I guess the other thing to sort of talk about there is that I'm surprised that once HKA sort of answered back, you know, with a bite there down in the street section, you know, they still got walked over again straight after that. You thought they would be able to stabilize after that, you know, drag out a little bit of time there on point two. But the play coming out from AHQ, the way that they sort of, you know, get all the positions that they need to get, they don't even let them have a chance to sort of contest them there.
And HQ, they had a really interesting attack as well in terms of the second checkpoint in particular. They pushed out quite far. They got the very aggressive hold at this front there. And, like, that's a fine thing to do, but eventually the 6v5 is what they have to deal with at those sort of front lines. They didn't really have any, to my memory anyway, they didn't have really that many ultimates to work with to sort of push that advantage any further. In fact, they end up losing that team fight after the card only just got to the bookstore corner. So for Crappy, didn't get a super amount of mileage off that. A single person on the cart just sort of slowly making their way around. But HQ, that was a very short-lived aggressive attack.
If only you could amp the cart up a little bit, eh, you know? Boost around the corner.
Buy more loot boxes. next patch.
You know, we've got that subliminal advertising here for
everything. All your abilities get stronger when you buy loot boxes.
I just need me some more duplicates, you know? Can't have me enough coins. Ridiculous, really. But we're getting straight back into this one. Let's see if K4 can find himself a little bit more room here. Definitely was getting punished towards the end of the checkpoint number three there. You know, not getting anything done at all. Is he going to be on that I guess, well-known McCree by now, seeing what he can find with this one.
Let's see what HQ are going to be able to attempt to do on this defensive team. Already jumping in, Discord Orb on Eric in as well. K4 just very composed at the moment, uses deflect to try and get a little bit of damage back from Dizzy, but so far HQ are not letting up any sort of space. Let's see what HKA can get done. That's the mech gone for Lazy Titan. Could be attacking time. Finally, there goes Dizzy on his way to try and track down Shao Lin, but Jin Kao finds him on the side. Eddie Boss hits a sleep dart, but his team is absolutely falling apart. Hong Kong Attitude have so much space to work with here.
Yeah, that flashbang missing was absolutely so disappointing there for Dizzy. Pays the price there. Look at him, he's going to switch up straight to the Tracer there after they just get demolished on the first attack. HKA showing actually very dominating performance here on their first attack. A lot of ultimates to work with. Dragonblade going to be up very soon as well. Same with the Transcendence. Not much charge here for the side of AHQ. And this is what makes HKA's first attack here so good, is that they gave up very little ultimate charge here to the side of AHQ.
Yeah, Hong Kong Attitude as well, they played it super patiently. They didn't lose members early. A Ting sort of got in there. Their first target was actually, they got down Lazy Titan's mech, and then after that they started turning on the gas. Went for the flank onto Dizzy as well, but before we get there, fight number two already underway. Eriken looking for a little bit of space in the front line. Shadow lands the pulse bomb onto Crappy on the other side. There goes the charge. Jin Kao looking to lose his mech, but not before the Transcend from Mango Junkie come in. It's K4 with a triple on the sword so far, looking for number four. Will he get it? Doesn't even matter. All of AHQ fall over.
Amazing stuff there as well. Transcendence coming in at the nick of time as well. Maybe a little bit of overcommitment there, but I mean, better to be safe than sorry in these situations. K4 though, doing an absolutely ripper job there, just absolutely demolishing AHQ. But now AHQ, a lot of ultimates in the bank of their own, finally got some charge up themselves. Let's see what they can find here.
Again, a decent amount of footing on the front line. And there goes the Earthshadow. I don't know if they're actually connected or not. It's still on the front line. Self-destructs on both sides are going to be able to work. Maybe number two. Nope, that doesn't hit anybody either. Down comes the Graviton Surge from AHQ, locking down a Ting and Jin Kao. But none of those two tanks will be falling over. Still, though, CQB Mango and a Ting, they're going to be the ones falling over. Hong Kong Attitude will have to come back and push another time.
Like that Graviton Surge there, I mean, even though they didn't manage to take those tanks out, the tanks were not there to keep the Zenyatta and the Ana alive there, sorry, the Lucio. And it was so very simple for them to walk over and just destroy the two support characters. And then after that, doesn't matter, fight is most definitely lost for HKA. AHQ now looking very strong here. Now on the street space, managed to stabilize a little bit here. Let's see if they can hold on to this though. Pulse Bomb up on Shaiyu, looking to get a lot of work done with this. Eddie Boss and Dizzy though do have a couple of ultimates of their own.
From Dizzy as well. Look, what can he get a stick on? Was looking for Mango Jai, isn't going to get it.
Stick
on straight onto the pavement. Eat that concrete, you take it. Shaolin on the other hand is going to be able to take down Eddie Boss, and Hong Kong Attitude still able to push back AHQ, but this could be the push that they're looking for. So far the cart isn't that far off either. Lazy Titan outside of the mech, Little Girl Diva is going to have to fall.
And this is such a tug of war right now between these two teams, back and forth constantly. HKA going to be able to push onto checkpoint two, see what they can get done here, onto checkpoint number three. Now K4 up in the top position there, watch him to get that flank with the Dragon Blade. If AHQ read this very well, manage to counterplay that out, this is what they're going to be looking for. Otherwise, K4 is just going to butter them like bread, to be honest.
And Hong Kong Attitude, we have K4 looking on the top lines. There goes the Dragon Blade, number one target. It's going to actually end up being Dizzy, followed by Eddie Boss as well. Only three members now left alive for AHQ. Self-destruct, it's only just going to take down CQB. The front line is still falling apart for AHQ. Down goes Lazy Titan, and I think Cowman's going to have to back out of this one pretty soon as well. He's not even going to get a chance to do that.
Well, all the ultimates though in hand here for AHQ. A lot to work with. Dizzy finding himself a nice little kill there onto a Ting. So now AHQ, once the respawns come up, looking good to take this fight to HKA just before they get their big Winston back to help them out there. And look at that, no time wasted as well. Eric going to be jumping straight up into the back lines, but good recovery here from HKA, not committing too much at all, just falling back. And now a Ting going to be switching over to the Reinhardt, so they're going to have the big shield to work with as well. K4 actually up on the soldier this time as well. Here we go, Reinhardt looking to swing this hammer up in the back lines. Finds that fire strike. Jin Kao going to be the one to take him out though. And that is how HKA are starting to make their move on the defensive.
And a lot of the HQ members are actually out of position here. Where is Eric Kemp? Finally jumps in onto the front line supporting his team. It's just two tanks and a support. They're not getting absolutely anywhere near enough damage. Can Eric Kemp be the hero that HQ needs? Losing his health, finally goes down to Shayu Lim. This should be the cap out finally. It will just be two more members. Last one, Cowman with the Graviton Surge does end up falling over. HKA get the cat.
And Easy muddles his words up, as per usual.
It's very close times, 237 to 250.
Yeah, so it also shows, obviously, how we sort of talked about these two teams being so evenly matched here, you know, moving into the time bank now. This all comes down to, you know, those adaptations. I feel that so far, HKA have sort of shown that they're a little bit better at sort of reading, you know, the opponent there, you know, making those changes when needed. And I feel that time bank's going to favour them ever so slightly here, but I mean, AHQ look like a completely different team here on Kingsborough.
I think AHQ have a decent amount to work with as well. Both teams are quite adaptable, but I think for Hong Kong Attitude, they've got a little bit more that they can work with. If they decide to pull Jin Kao back out on the fair, the pharmacy is something that they can go back to. They just have to worry about the Z on the McCree. But so far, AHQ, what's been really standout is I think their defense has been fairly solid, but Hong Kong Attitude coming at them really hard.
I guess that's really the thing to note there, eh? That Hong Kong Attitude, very strong offense, but on the defense, you know, they don't really have that same sort of, I guess, solid sort of composition that AHQ have. You know, the times are quite equal there, but it felt that AHQ really, on the defense, you know, when they defended very, very well. You know, dealing with K4, they made it look so very easy.
It was a really interesting start for AHQ on their attack as well. You know, forcing K4 out of that top position and then sort of just losing it a little bit while later. Let's see what HKA are going to get with their initial time bank attack.
Oh, K4 switching over to the Genji right from the start here, not opting to stick on the Soldier. That was somewhat working out for them towards point number three there. But Dizzy actually back on the Soldier here, no McCree this time. I think this worked out a little bit safer for them there. They managed to, Hong Kong Attitude managed to pick him off very easily in their first attack last time. But here it is, going to be Shayu just going to be working his way there, getting a little bit of damage done, looking to get a pulse bomb up. K4 though, up in the high ground here, but it's going to be Mango Dry dropping on that Zenyatta. Now with that one player down, going to be very hard for them to push in here, and this K4 can find a lot of damage up in the back line.
Yeah, this is the thing with HQ as well, they were able to sort of, Hong Kong Attitude actually split their attack up, so half the members went up on the clock tower side to try and pressure that top area. The other half of the members obviously don't have the ability to scale those walls, so they're still on the ground, and HQ sort of, they're able to look at the ground team and say, we got these three tanks, we're able to just pressure them out. In fact, no, they're running two tanks, but even just a combination, Lazy Titan, Eric Ken, able to pressure the ground team out. The upper team couldn't really get that much work done either. Hong Kong Attitude now looking for a second opportunity to push the HQ. Look at that, composed, just backing out his team.
I think starting that one off though, getting right up in the grill of AHQ, pushing a lot of these players back at Shayu right by his side, finds one more, and that's going to be his counterpart Tracer as well. He's got the pulse bomb to work with as well. Shayu needs to be dealt with right now. He's going to be able to do a lot of work up here in the back line if they don't manage to take him down. Crappy gets taken out there as well. CQB being a better Lucio in this situation, but Dizzy with the nano visor coming in right now finds himself K4 looking for a second here. Can he find anything? And it's going to be Shayu out on the side picking him up there, comes in as well and takes down Eric. And look at this, HKA answering back with force.
HKA are going to secure themselves the cap with 50 seconds left to spare. Traitor have kind of just dodged that overtime for now. Both teams actually got a decent amount of time to work with, sort of expecting the expected mileage, I guess, for the car push should be roughly near the second checkpoint, but it would be difficult to actually get the full cap out. Here comes Ultimates Online for K4 and also Mango Giant heading into the streets phase, and they're going to need everything they can get as we're about to get into overtime.
Going to have that self-destruct to work with now on both sides, so Lazy Titan, a lot of pressure on him here. We'll have the sound barrier up on Crappy as well, quite getting under way now. Kalman looking to get up in the back lines here off the side of HKA. The damage is done to Crappy though. The Dragon Blade coming through. Finds Eddie Boss and Eric as well. Big triple there coming out from K4, and CQB being the last player as well, picking up a couple himself. HKA losing no members now, pushing the cart with four on it.
The thing about HQ is that was actually fine for them. They delayed the cart for a significant amount of time. Look, we're only just around the bookstore now. Already into the overtime, still three ultimates online for AHQ. They just have to win this next fight, and they have the tools to do that. K4 onto the McCree as well. Gonna slow things down just a little bit. They're gonna have to they have to slow push this for now on.
He's gonna have to hit the best headshots of his life here if they want any chance of winning this fight out. Here come the ultimates from AHQ. Self-destruct coming in. Counter sound barrier from both sides here. going to be keeping both of these teams alive. That's the pulse bomb from Kalman, finding a ting mid-air as well. And AHQ looking good as they push in onto this one. There comes that self-destruct. Doesn't find anything up in the back lines. Discord all going to be on Crappy. Is anyone putting the pressure onto him, though? I can't see anyone in DK4 keeping the back line safe. Finds Kalman as Tracer tries to get up in behind them. Crappy, not going to be enough damage there to keep them alive. And Dizzy with the Helix Rocket there onto K4. Just a little bit of a consolation, managing to escape with his life. But let's see, HKA going to get aggressive onto him. It's what they need to start doing right now, running out of time as they're still in the overtime.
If Hong Kong Attitude can get this cap, it's a really big deal. Dizzy's going to do all he can to prevent that, but he's going to go for 1v1 with the Ting. It's probably not going to last too much longer. He is using up a lot of the Ting's time, so that's not too bad on the side. Kalman on the back line has a pulse bomb, but he gets to stick on the Lazy Titan. Doesn't manage to get the kill, but gets the mech instead. Now, Lazy Titan, wrong way around, he got him to Jinkal. Lazy Titan still on the front lines, able to get a decent amount of damage, preventing any further car movement. Don't forget, still into the overtime. It's Mango Giant Shaolin getting the pay, but getting
and
the kills.
Hong Kong Attitude, with so much attitude indeed, not wanting to let up any of this pressure. Definitely want to get checkpoint number two now, and it looks like they will be able to do it. Can they even possibly get checkpoint number three in this overtime?
It's a tall order, but then again, so was getting checkpoint number two. I said, look, if you can get checkpoint number two, that's going to be a pretty decent achievement, considering they went into the overtime just around the bookstore. So there's a lot of work to be done here still. K4 this time going to be onto the Soldier. See if we can get a bit more work done than on the creep.
I mean, if they can get these ultimates up and drop them before ASU manage to catch up on the percentage there, this is going to be their chance. Discord all finds its mark here, and now it's going to be Eric in a very tough situation, and tough is indeed what it is. He pays with his life there. Is he finding that trade kill there? And here comes the Transcendence to keep the rest of the team alive. Self-destruct coming right on the top. A little bit missed time there. Doesn't find anything with that one. And now look at this. Lazy Titan as well. Caught out of position. He should not be able to do much up there. Loses his mech as well. And will go down. And look at this, HKA with so much momentum, pushing for checkpoint number three.
They've still got Cowman and they've still got CQB of the Sound Barrier and Ting with the Primal Rage as well. They're going to have to use absolutely everything, and they're going to need it because Dizzy coming on with the tactical visor pretty soon. Eric Hen going to make the initial jump, and K4 cleaning up Eddie Boss onto the side. Down goes Crappy as well, and K4 is doing a ton of work on the flank, still undealt with. This is Shaolin taking down the mech as well. Mango Jai finally falls down, but so far there's no one left alive for AHQ. It's just Eric Hen getting pushed out. This is going to be the cap.
Unbelievable stuff there from HKA, managing to get all the way to the end 50 seconds after getting checkpoint number one, and do not even get stopped on their journey to checkpoint number three. Amazing push there. AHQ gonna have to answer
big time. I mean,
extremely loudly. Extremely loudly. They need a shout and scream if they want any chance
of getting it. When you make the calls to your own team, it's you're not just calling anymore, you're just shouting at your team now. You almost make it sound like the team's going on full tilt, like, what?
I mean, you're not going to be feeling very good, though, after getting that done to you there, you know? They really had no answer for HKA's push throughout the entire time, and I mean, K4 looking to get a lot of revenge, I feel, in that one. He looked like he was very fired up indeed towards the end. Oh, you wanted to camp me out every time I respawn? Now I'm going to do the same thing to you.
The really incredible thing is, when you really think about it, for AHQ, all they had to do was win one fight after the sort of bookstore corner. They just had to win one fight, and on some level they kind of just needed to compose themselves and be able to charge up a few extra ults, guarantee a fight where they're absolutely at the advantage, because every sort of fight was coming in against Hong Kong Attitude roughly even. Did feel like they lost a bit of patience there. Yeah, they would have probably had to throw in a couple of extra fights towards the early end, but they may have been able to prevent that second cap from going, and that would have been really important. 2:45 to go. AHU got to go with a perfect run here.
Yeah, safe lineups again from both sides here. We've seen these being used just before. Going to be the battle of the Zarya's, really. These Graviton Surge is going to be what make it or break it here. Dizzy trying to get himself control of a high ground. If he does manage to stay uncontested up here, there is not many players up here. It's going to be K4 versus Dizzy, the battle of the soldiers now. Who's the greatest old man? Let's find out. Dizzy going to be the aggressor, though, in this situation.
Who's going to get off whose lawn? Let's find out.
And HKA actually going to lose Jinkal very early there. Kalman definitely been doing more bicep kills than Jinkal. Takes him out as well. Now Dizzy controlling the high ground, takes down K4 as well. Shaiyu there to find a little bit of a trade. Don't know about Shaiyu here on the D.Va.
definitely was getting a lot more work done on the tracer here, and now Dizzy, we've seen him in this position before, finds CQB as well, getting to rain so many bullets from up here, and this is what AHQ are looking for, very aggressive first push, don't want to lose a fight of their own, and look at this, looking to even hunt down Jin Cao as well on the respawn.
And Dizzy fights so much to get that upper positioning as well, he's super, super forward now, wants to get as much of the early damage done as possible, he's actually very close to take Visor. And he's still staying safe. He understands, like, this is the limit. This is how far he walk up and still remains safe. Look at this, still keeping that high ground positioning. HQ did this last time. Now, last time HQ pushed this far forward, they eventually got punished for it. How long can they last here while Crappy gets the cap out? Graviton Surge being used by Cowman. Very reserved with attack visor. Isn't going to go there just yet. And K4, real, the last member alive. Is he going to go down? Cowman takes him out.
Unbelievable stuff here from AHQ, taking all the pages out of HKA's attack previously now, looking just as aggressive as their counterparts here, pushing all the way up past checkpoint number three as well, even slightly more aggressive, looking to answer back with a bit of vengeance here. They're not too happy about how obviously their defense went, and they really want to stick it right now to HKA.
Eventually this runs out though. Eventually your five members just loses out to the six-man team from HKA, and all HKA got to do is be able to group up for this. There goes the nano visor, gets earth shattered right behind him. A Ting, what a beautiful earth shatter. And now HKA turn on the gas. They found their key target. Dizzy going down. K4 got nanoed as well. Cowman dies. 37 seconds left to go. AHQ, they lose all momentum on cart. They're going to have to go for a full reset for Hong Kong Attitude. All they got to do is push up. If they push up now, force a very, very early fight. AHQ don't have time to muck around in the spawn. They have to get right back on the cart.
And a Ting with that German precision even, just finding that preemptive earth
shatter. Hong Kong engineering.
Hong Kong engineering indeed. Lands that earth shatter out of nowhere. I mean, what an absolute great read from him right there. He's definitely going to be if they manage to hold onto this defense, that's definitely the flex that they were looking for. Graviton Surge coming in there, K4 picking up another. HKA still finding all the kills here in the fight. It looks like Jin Cao trying to push up onto the top line there as well. Can't find anything at all. Oh, he can indeed. He actually will take down Lazy Titan as he tries to pressure him off there.
Oh, Dizzy.
Doesn't matter at all. Dizzy up in the back, getting taken out there by Shayu. And look at this, HKA just dealing with AHQ, stopping the snowball in its tracks, and hold this one before checkpoint number two and take the map.
Yeah, you slapped my hand, Mango. That's exactly what you needed. Oh, but Hong Kong, actually, they got to be very, very pleased with that one. The second time AHQ had been severely punished for making those aggressive plays. And look, it's not even the fact that they shouldn't be doing it. There's a limit of how far you can push out and how far you can survive with five members before the other team simply overwhelm you. Wonder which one this is going to be. I was kind of hoping for that that quad self-destruct play, but it's not going to be the one.
I mean, to be honest, I mean, let's be frank here. The play that wins in the game is a Ting's Earthshatter. The real play of the game.
There's the play of the game the game decides, and then there's the play of the game that we all know.
Is the actual
play of the game.
I mean, it looked like Dizzy was about to clean everybody up there in that exchange, and then just lands on some.
He absolutely needed to clean up, because if he didn't, that's exactly what happened. You see the result of not cleaning up. But yeah, like I said, there's a real limit to how far you can sort of push that kind of attack. Crappy's still pushing solo on the cart. You see the difference is Hong Kong Attitude didn't try and push up too far beyond what they could handle. They still fought as a six-man unit while keeping on the cart, keeping the momentum on the cart. And there's advantages to playing on the cart. I mean, the cart gives you passive healing, but also you've got you're grouped up with all six of your members, and playing 5v6 into the enemy team for HQ. Twice now they've understood, well, they should understand by now exactly what happens. You're playing 5v6, you can't last out there long enough until, you know, you have to be able to regroup eventually.
And it just comes down to this, those minor mistakes there. You know, AHQ looking so very good there. You know, they got the position exactly the same way that Hong Kong Attitude did to them in the prior offense there. Had a lot more time to work with. They could have just been very patient with it, but I think they just rushed a little bit too much, got a little bit too over aggressive, and then they paid the price, you know. I mean, they couldn't really read into the earth shatter though, let's be honest.
I think AHQ is you know, definitely got a little bit impatient, that realizing Hong Kong Attitude pushing all the way to the end in time bank, that's an incredibly difficult thing to do. And so for AHQ, they sort of just had to just go balls to the wall for that one. They couldn't hold anything back, understood they had to go all out to be able to make the same distance. And credit to them, they got a decent amount of distance at the end, but just wasn't enough. That final play with Dizzy being shut down by Oteng, I think that really made all the difference.
I mean, we also got to see as well Dizzy be such a standout player, you know, for his side there, actually winning a lot of those battles with K4. And I mean, doing that in itself, you know, is such a big, I suppose, you know, achievement in itself. You know, gets that high ground control over him every single time almost, and then pretty much winning these fights out for his side there. But the thing is, Oteng was just, I guess, their kryptonite this match.
Oteng was definitely a big factor, particularly on Kings, you know, mostly on Kings Row. I didn't really feel it so much on Lee Jung Tower, but
This match. Maybe we should go get the dictionary
Overwatch,
out after.
This Overwatch. This Overwatch game. I mean, Oteng just had it.
What is meanings of words?
I do quite like the way AHQ attempt to sort of work their way around the first checkpoint. They always like to play Dizzy with the Soldier in particular on the attacking side. Anyway, they go into the bottom side, up the stairs, around the clock tower, and force K4 out of his hiding spot, and then just sort of stick Dizzy up there with the Soldier gun raining down bullets. And the first time we saw that on their attack, it didn't really work out, because although Dizzy got the positioning, the rest of his team, the five on the floor, kind of got mopped up. Now this time around, he was able to do enough damage on the top. Killing Oteng quite early definitely helped them out there. I saw the headshots raining down above. That's the other thing. The extremely good angle, I mean, for the Reinhardt play, for the tanks, you're pointing your shield towards the team on the ground. You're not looking at Dizzy above, behind you, and he's getting such easy shots on you. Completely melts you from above. And for Hong Kong Attitude as well, they had nothing really to sort of deal with it. They had nothing to counter Dizzy hiding in that upper position, and they didn't have that last time either, but thankfully they won the ground in the fight. Now if they didn't win that, it would have been the same story for HQ. They would have been able to push through quite forcefully.
I think the difference was in the first exchange, correct me if I'm wrong here, maybe you caught it, maybe you can correct me in the chat as well, K4 actually stayed alive once Dizzy managed to gain the position.
Yeah, so K4 jumped down and then went underneath the archway and just sort of sat at the archway.
Yeah, and just cleaned up the ground.
And Dizzy went to look for him as well. Dizzy actually went around the side to see if he can find K4 as well. Couldn't really find him. And by the time Dizzy was sort of attempting to help his team on the ground, I mean, K4 is dealing a lot more damage while being on the ground than Dizzy was up on the perch. So that's just sort of it's a really good play from AHQ, but just kind of unfortunate execution on the first time around. The second time around is exactly what they were meant to do the first time, and it worked the second time.
And that's because obviously he finds that kill onto K4, you know, and I think it's because K4, you know, is feeling a little bit more confident in himself, you know, he's feeling his Helix rocket a little bit, wants to take the fight with Dizzy, you know, and then he...
Just like Beyonce, he's feeling himself.
Oh, God damn, baby girl.
So yeah, K4 had a pretty good game as well, going up against a multitude of heroes. You know, we haven't even seen the K4's Widowmaker come out yet. We saw that on Ilios for that one tiebreaker, but aside from that, K4's been playing mostly Genji, and then Soldier and a little bit of McCree. Just had a little bit of McCree in there, just a couple shots in there.
A little sprinkle of McCree dust.
But yeah, headshots. But Soldier's definitely a lot more of his sort of safe pick. It's more of the the general expected mileage you can get out of Soldier, whereas on McCree it's very hit or miss. It is McCree's super hit or miss. If you're either landing 140 headshots or you're really not
140
doing it.
Specifically 140.
Pretty sure it's 140 headshots.
140. There it is. If you're not getting 140 damage headshots.
What were you thinking?
I thought you meant you were hitting 140 headshots match. If you're not hitting 140 headshots per game.
Let me try that again. Oh, you mean like 100? I thought you meant 140 degrees.
No.
We're talking about total.
I thought you were talking about a specific number of headshots. I'm like, okay. So that's
you got to hit 140 degree, 140 damage headshots all the time.
Every time you shoot, you just jerking it quickly.
Because you're really sore wrist after that.
No, your head as well, though, you know, like...
Why do you have to do that with your head?
Maybe you got a screen that moves.
I don't know.
They got 144. They got 244.
This is getting out of control. But this is why he doesn't play McCree. This is why he went back on the Soldier. He's like, I'm not hitting that 140. I can't do that.
I definitely can't do that either.
But yeah, but Genji as well is sort of less safe as well, because you sort of have to... Genji feels... almost kind of binary as well, because he's really doing quite pitiful damage from range, just throwing the shooting stars out there. It's not really It's not really that fantastic, not reliable damage. Just sort of getting those stars out there. Like, take my stars, please. You really have to put yourself in a lot of danger, dash in, and get those, get them all scattered. I don't even know what it is when you throw all three stars, the ult fire. That's when you're really starting to do some damage on Genji and then building up your ult, obviously. But with Soldier, he's pretty much effective at every single range. So Soldier is like the safest DPS pick.
And obviously it's a much better, I think it's better to sprinkle bullets and helix rockets on the enemy team than it is to try and sprinkle, you know, 140 headshots.
You're being asked to do an Italian accent.
What?
Anyway, yeah.
Not again! So true story here, actually. I've been, trying to brush up on my Russian here. And supposedly, when I put my Russian accent on, all I do is sound Italian. I'm not going to go and say my Russian words because my my vocabulary is limited to, you know, just a couple of bad words. But, you know, I've got one, you know.
You learned all the most important ones first.
I've got one.
That way when you get to the country, you're like, I'll just say the words I know. That's really good.
It's perfect. You know, this is like obviously what I need to say to my girlfriend, like, repeatedly. It's, sit down.
Sedieť.
Just... It's the hand motion. It's the hand motion that sells.
Oh man, if she's watching, I'm done. I never say that to you, I'm sorry.
Yeah. It doesn't. Once you got the hand motion in there, that's when you know it's... What does that even mean? Do people do that? I'm pretty sure that's...
Back to Overwatch.
I don't think people do that. I'd be offended if I was Italian right now.
If you are Italian in the chat, I do apologize. That is not what you sound like at all. It's far more attractive than that. I definitely can't do it. I'll just keep to my fish and chips.
Oh. Anyway.
Or my fish and chops, I should say. There was a bit of an Australian twang going on there. If you're Australian, I'm also sorry. I'm just gonna go.
So I'll see myself out later. Next pick is going to be Hanamura. It is going to be Hong Kong Attitude's pick. Are we going to see the K4 Widowmaker come out or not? That's going to be something that's going to be quite interesting as well. Just get yourself back.
I think what we're going to see, actually, I think a lot of people are going to take that page out of Zonda's book from last night. I think we're going to see...
That nerd spot on the second checkpoint.
Well, I mean...
The real sweaty spot that Zonda found.
I think it's the boys on AHQ, you know, they've got their towels out, so they are, you know, wiping the sweat off their hands, so they're... They've got it ready, I reckon.
Oh, guys, look at this.
Oh, guys, well, we've got to get up on the top spot in Hanamura.
It's a real sweaty spot up there.
Well, obviously it was so sweaty, even Blank were like, well, we know where he is. We just can't get him. Why can't we do anything to get him? You know what we'll do?
Pick a Reaper.
We'll get shotguns.
Yeah, we'll get a shotgun. It'll help us get through the May War. Oh, but how do you get this on the...
Teleport, remember? We talked about this in our in-depth analysis. You know, you just kind of peek out there and say, hello, mate, I'm coming. You know?
Hello, mate. Wait for me. Just stay where you are.
Like, oh, you know what? Actually, yeah, come on. I'll give you a chance this time, you know? Still trying to find some good players to play against.
Yeah, that's... I hope Zonda finds some good players soon, because... Looking for good opponents.
I'll just stare down the barrel there as well. Just like, hope you're watching that one, mate. I've said it.
But for Hong Kong Attitude, if they clean this one up, they will be, after week two, the only still undefeated team, fully undefeated, 100% win rate.
So I guess, you know, we talked about that Clash of the Titans, you know, being Flash Wolves coming up against Blank, but it looks like the real clash, you know, one of those teams is actually going to be the first team to, I guess, you know, go undefeated, you know, if they come
I'll
up against
each other
like that.
If Hong Kong Attitude go 3-0 against HQ, that's technically a better result than Blank did against HQ.
A Hong Kong Attitude? Now the favourites? Too soon to say.
From Hong Kong, they are.
Well, yeah, I mean... I noticed that there's a lot of like sort of national pride, you know, going on with all of these teams. You know,
it's an interesting team because Mango is nationally from Hong Kong. The other five are actually, I believe, from Taiwan, representing Hong Kong. So that is, it's also a really interesting sort of dynamic there. It's like, go to Hong Kong, maybe.
Maybe. Oh, I'm actually dying from that. That was too good. Good.
The good news is you know, having five Taiwanese nationals as well as being the fact that the tournament's played in Taiwan works out, I guess, kind of logistically works out a little bit better for them. And they're a bit more familiar with the territory. I guess sort of for Blank, What are you smiling
about? I'm still laughing at how you said that. And so I'm sorry if I stop what you're about to say.
I'm just saying, like, for Blank and Fireball, like, they had to come such a far way into a totally foreign country, and that's not to say that it has any effect on their game. Certainly, I don't think it's had a big effect on Blank's game. Maybe in week one it did.
I think they kind of like being the kind of villains of the tournament, if you will. Not really having a lot of
local
support. Yeah,
I did sort of hear
about
that as well. Is like they don't Blank. Blank don't really have much of local support. They don't have a lot of the local fans there. Obviously, they've been kind of beating the Taiwanese teams, and that's not going to make the Taiwanese fans very happy about that.
Yeah, I mean, like, and you heard in there, I think it was... trying to think which was it? The Kiwi Trills interview. And no, it was Trills interview. And when he sort of, you know, there's no cheering at all.
At all.
And then he mentions one thing about, you know, Flash Tools May being better than theirs.
Oh, yeah.
And the whole crowd's like, woo, love it. Beautiful.
Oh, everyone, but they all cheered about ATAR sucking as well. I was like,
yes, ATAR does suck.
It does suck. I agree.
What we're going to be
That's not like, oh, Trill's just making it funny. That's like, yes, he's correct. Yeah, yeah. It does suck, I believe.
Well, when I tweeted at Trill as well, he said he was only telling the truth. So straight from the horse's mouth indeed.
Trill, no lies.
Well, Crappy actually going to be... Look, they've done it again. And I think Crappy's talked about this as well in his interview as well about how, you know,
yeah,
they want to play
that. Yeah, didn't we see this
Torbjorn
last time? We did see this last time. MC Crappy ripped out the Torbjorn.
MC Crappy. Love how he holds his microphone. Let's hope he holds his mouse in the same kind of
gangster
way. Maybe he's got that gangster lean as well when he shoots a shotgun.
Yeah, when he's got the Torbjorn gun out, he actually holds it sideways. Okay.
Anyway, in all seriousness, there goes the turret. It gets taken out by...
That lasted a lot longer than Flash Wolf's turret.
Oh,
just saying.
I mean, did they even plant it? I mean, yes, they did. And look at this, Jin Kao all over it. This is a completely different Pharah that we've seen before. K4 there to clean up Dizzy as he tries to escape into the house. Now Eddie Boss trying to keep the rest of the team alive here. Crappy looking to get a lot of damage done with the gun. Needs to find the shot here onto K4. They do manage to take him down. It's going to be Kalman to get the job done there. Now Nano Boost up onto Kalman as well.
That's a fast Nano Boost. I mean, he hasn't actually... Did he use that? Yes, he did. Eddie Boss used that one.
And look at this, Crappy managing to get the turret up here on the point. Got some scrap to work with now as well. Trying to get it up to level 2. Can't manage to find it at all as HKA are cleaning up on the point. Indeed, got a nano boost of their own, but no one dealing with the Zarya, and that's going to be the big issue. Once she starts focusing you down, it's going to be so difficult to deal with this. The charge is going to be up. But with the whole side of AHQ starting to move their way in, it's going to be difficult for HKA to get back in this. But the pulse bomb from Shayu keeping it alive.
It's actually very even HQ. Crappy's got the Molten Core out here as well. He will eventually go down. Eventually? No, he doesn't. K4 loses his Dragon Blade. That's a bit of an upset coming up from Cowman. Crappy just runs away with his little legs in life.
Little legs?
So he's a dwarf. Come on.
But he's still bulking up though. He's definitely been doing this.
He's
a robot, isn't he? Really? He's got like robot legs and a robot arm. He's got one arm. He's bulking. I think we talked about this the other day.
He loses his robot turret to Jin Kao. Still in the air. The first target for Jin Kao every time he comes out. K4 unleashes the Dragon Blade as well on the side. Manages to kill Crappy. And what can Jin Kao find now? Finds his death from Dizzy.
This time he finds two with the Dragon Blade. Somehow that previous kill wasn't actually a shutdown, even though the blade was out.
Yeah, I thought he would have lost his ultimate, but no.
But look at this, AHQ answer back, and they get themselves so many out of this one. It's going to be Mango Jai Force to fall back. Are they going to hunt him down though? They are not going to bother with this. Manages to get himself back to the safety of the team there, and now going to be AHQ. Quite a few ultimates here to work with as well. Got the Nano Visor as the main, combo they're going to be going through here. HKA are going to have to get themselves through this choke point very quickly. Crappy going to be able to get himself up another turret.
Now we're sort of at the stage now where there's a decent amount of scrap on the field, there's a decent amount of HP. Crappy's really got to chuck out an armor pack for Dizzy at some point though, who really, really needs it. But it's also difficult for HQ to get out. This is the kind of triple tank front door defense that's very hard to get through. The good news for HKA is they were running Jin Kao the Fair. They completely changed up into a different composition. Now K4 and Soldier, probably a safer lineup, but they're going to struggle to get past this front door. That's the problem.
Yeah, they're getting held at this choke point, and the angle on the turret there as well. You know, usually you wouldn't really go for that if there was that Pharah still alive. It would be very easy to be taken out there, but they're not even too worried with all those tanks up in the front line holding it down there. Dizzy smacking Jin Kao in the face and off the map, back into the spawn. And now HKA running out of time, 25 seconds
healing.
Left.
I need healing. Can't find his healer. Does find Shaolin on the other side though.
Yeah, I think he heard the footsteps in there, but maybe he was just got the emotes.
I thought he was going for a
Graviton surge on the entire team, getting absolutely wiped right now. HKA, no answer to this choke point hold coming out from AHQ right now.
That was pretty big. 2 seconds left to go, and HKA haven't found any chance to get through that front door. Like I said, look, even the molten, cheeky molten core in the
that
fish
and chip
shop.
Biggest pub turret I've ever seen right there. Like, that's something like you just drop it in there, you know, right at the start. No one notices it. They all just run through
the door.
That's
the kind of thing that when I see that, that makes me think that's enough Overwatch for today. That's enough Overwatch.
I mean, the worst one is even when you put it up on the second level, you know, that's the even cheekier. The cheekier position.
Let's talk about the fact that, so, Hong Kong Attitude ran the triple DPS. They tried to break it through. In fact, I think the triple DPS had better success than the composition they eventually ran, because AHQ, by the way, it's all smiles on their faces. They're like, whoa, this might actually be a game. Putting the three tanks on the front line, locking down the doors, this is the strat. This is how Blank were sort of holding Hanamura the first time we saw them playing against Detonated as well. Hold the doors with three tanks. You can't get anyone past that because it's just way too much HP, way too much pressure. On the back though, anyone that does try and dash past, there's a turret to meet them. Dizzy is waiting on the sort of high ground there as well. I almost feel keeping the triple DPS with the Genji, with the Tracer and the Pharah, that's far better at dealing with at sort of sneaking past the tanks and finding openings than what Hong Kong Attitude eventually went for, which is the more tank heavy plus soldier lineup where all you're doing is trading health with tanks on the front line, and it takes a very long time to actually manage to break past that triple tank lineup in the front. You have to be able to severely outdamage them. And Hong Kong Attitude, they had no time to do that whatsoever.
I mean, I kind of think in that situation, they could have really gone for just going for the Roadhog, you know what I mean? The second they sort of drop the shield, you know, maybe get the Artist Sleep Dart on them, gets dropped, hook in, pull them out of the choke point, and that's how you can sort of really open that one up. And look at that, look at that, look at that, look at that, look at that. Calvin knows what I'm talking about. He goes on the Roadhog.
You're feeling so validated.
I am indeed right now.
Yes, someone did it.
I knew it. He knew it, and I knew it. But the interesting thing to note as well, just before we get into this first attack here, HKA, this is their pick. So, I mean, they almost met. It looks like they almost might
be. Well, there was a hook. Unfortunately, he hooked Lazy Titan, who just flew back away. But it did give them the opening to sort of just sneak through. So, this is good. Look at HQ's position. This is what our Hong Kong Attitude needed. They need to get their whole team past their front gate. Now Hong Kong Attitude have to completely reshuffle their defense as well indoors.
Well, AHQ, look at that. They've got the control of the high ground balcony out of there as well, and they can actually get a couple of their players around the backside. They will be able to just hold this one down and wait.
Kelman goes fishing on the side again.
And he gets one, but it's going to be another diva.
It's almost like you go fishing, it's like, oh, not another shoe.
Honestly, I think it'll be so hard to fish up a shoe. If someone has ever fished up a shoe, please let me know.
That's an achievement. You'd be happy. Anyway.
Getting into this. And the positioning here, you know, from AHQ, very good. Look at this Dizzy up in the top lines. There comes the dead eye and the hook. There it is. And that's going to open that one up for AHQ. Just wiping up a couple of these HKA players. HKA not knowing what to do with themselves right now. AHQ so aggressive up on this point. The healing rocket finding Jin Kao. Tactical visor coming in.
This is the game.
Well.
This is the game.
AHQ wastes no time at all. We are going to map number 4.
HQ sitting there like, you picked what?
You made a huge mistake.
Picked what? You think you're going to get into the nerd spot on the second checkpoint? Mate, we're not even going to get to the second checkpoint. This game's done.
I mean, you know, look at Crappy with his sweat towel. You see what I'm saying?
Here comes the drink bottle.
Oh. All right, here we go, guys. We've got the play-by-play. Let's see how we... okay. Looking really forward to how he's going to drink the drink.
He's going to put it down sideways, and here comes...
He actually probably was. Good play of the game here.
That hook on the
hook's side. The play of the game.
That hook was the real play of the game.
All right, so this is what we're going to start doing from here on out. You know, we'll give the Overwatch play of the game, you know, a look over, and then
sometimes
we'll
it is actually the play of the game.
Oh, true. It is definitely true. Definitely.
Like a decent amount of times, it is the play of the game is really the play of the game too.
Yeah, you know, he obviously did more than just the hook, but maybe if the dead.
The hook was impressive because you've got not really. Okay. Like mechanically, the hook's not impressive because it was like
standing still.
It was a standing still McCree. Like that's about the easiest. If you miss that, there's a problem. But the impact of it was really big because, you know, Hong Kong Attitude really needed that ultimate. They really needed the Deadeye to do something for that to just get hooked out. And also just really good for Cowman to finally get a hook up and just, Diva! Diva!
Just fishing. It's more, I'm trying to think of something, I haven't been fishing in so long, you know, just fishing up, I want to say, that's not even a, I've got nothing. I've got absolutely nothing.
Last time I went fishing.
Anytime you catch anything, you're kind of like, yes.
Last time I
went
fishing,
seagull,
really,
maybe a seagull.
A seagull.
A seagull. I tell you a true story, actually.
Is that possible?
My father has actually fished a seagull 2 times.
Out of the water?
No.
Oh.
As in, like, goes to cast. Seagull out of nowhere, comes in, hooks it out of him, and then he's gonna have to battle the seagull and, you know, like, kind of try.
Oh, in the air?
Yeah, like, it'll just come in and just swoop it.
The mental image I'm getting of seagull getting hooked is
true.
No,
story. That's almost like... Not a seagull, you know, the Overwatch player seagull.
No, I know that. Wow, why don't we go there, please? That's almost like you hook a diva and the diva starts flying away mid-hook and you're just like, come back here! Please. Oh, yeah. I thought you meant fish the seagull out of the water.
No. I don't know how the seagulls are swimming at this point.
Because you say fish, and we're like, good. Oh, how does a seagull get in? Like, what the? How did that happen?
You know, up north, those seagulls are obviously not getting fed too well, it seems. You know, they're really, really bolding the wharf, you know, really want to get themselves a bit of that fish bait.
I think AHQ are going to be fishing for another map win if they can. This is going to go to 4 maps. I said this was likely to go the actual full distance of 5 maps. Now we're going to go back onto, it's going to be AHQ's pick now. So we just had Hanamura. It's going to be a escort. So it's Dorado, Gibraltar, and Route 66. There we go. I didn't even need your help this time.
Oh, good.
I got
you
it got there
it.
On my
you
own.
Got it. I was like,
took the training
wheels. I was
off.
Hoping, being like, come on, forget one, let me talk. Love the sound of my own voice. Not really.
And so far we've seen Dorado.
No, we saw Dorado and we saw Route 66.
Did we? Yes, we did see Route 66. We haven't seen Gibraltar yet. No one likes that map. So Route and Dorado, I feel like big fan of Dorado. Route's pretty open. Dorado and Route have sort of very open areas and they kind of feel like quite similar maps to me. Obviously Dorado has a lot more of those high up spaces, and now this being AHQ's pick, I feel like they would prefer, what would they prefer here? It's interesting. I probably think. They're all very aerial, vertical maps as well. Particularly Gibraltar is a super like vertical map in terms of that second hangar checkpoint as well. So
I think if they get on that,
this is a big Genji map. This is going to be a big Genji map, I think.
Well, that as well. They can play with the Pharah there, obviously.
Yeah.
And I think that favors HKA ever so slightly more. I think that K4 on the Pharah is. I wouldn't say Leech.
Jin Callum, sorry.
Oh my goodness, I'm silly.
Dizzy's the other favorite player, but the thing is, you don't. The reason.
I always just like, oh, K4. It's always K4.
K4 plays every. He's so good. All
he's
K4s.
No, but Jin Callum has been, I think, a much more standout player than Dizzy on the Pharah there.
Problem with running Jin Callum and Pharah is you lose desire, so you're starting to get these trades where you lose out on one thing if you do run something else. And for HQ, that's if you run Dizzy on the Pharah, you lose out on his. Everything else, and his everything else, the Soldier, the Tracer, the McCree, has been so good. Not to say his Pharah isn't good, but to lose out on those heavy hit scans that he's been sort of massively pulling his weight for, that's a big deal.
I think it's going to be interesting to see if they do go for that Gibraltar. I mean, how do you sort of feel about this map as a whole at the moment?
It's interesting because on one hand, there's been a couple of changeups where you need to run some heroes that can scale vertically, such as, you know, Winston. D.Va's probably a big one, so, but you also need to be able to play on the ground and push the cart, so you have to have these two points of control. You need to be able to control the airspace, you need to be able to control that height space, and you have to be able to control the ground as well, so you're required to run with the Reinhardt, particularly on the attacking team, and definitely on the defensive team, I think, as well, on the ground battle. The team without a Reinhardt is severely behind and disadvantaged on the ground battle, but the team that doesn't run a vertically scaling hero like a D.Va for tank is going to be disadvantaged there as well. So you kind of want to run a Genji and then also a D.Va, but then also a Reinhardt and something that can really do a lot of damage on the ground as well. So I think Hog is actually not bad on any of these maps because he's got enough presence that he's useful on the ground and he can sort of counter the high ground as well. So yeah, there's a few interesting things to sort of look out for there.
I mean, it's the thing, we saw him come into play last night, you know, old sneaky shotgun. Sneaky shotgun man himself.
Oh, sneaky.
Sneaky Reapy.
Shotgun litterer.
Sneaky Reapy.
The litterer.
You know, they can obviously get the old teleport, you know, get the old big swag up the top there as well.
Get the gang sign teleport up there.
You know, and the old, the classic pub drop, die, you know, from the upwards there. But I mean, you usually got the D.Va sitting up on that sort of top. I don't know what
Reaper's
you call that position.
Reaper's been severely out of the meta for some time now, I think.
But this is his chance. This is his moment. If we do get Gibraltar. Unless it's a Maywall, but it is
going to be Dorado. It's going to be Dorado, but I think, you know, no matter what, Reaper doesn't really have a place in any of these picks anymore. He's just...
Anti-Maywall.
Sure. Anti-Maywall still can't kill Zonda.
Well, I mean, no, I'm not going to go through all of our... Well, if you're just...
We won't repeat that again joined. No, we're not going to repeat that section. check the VOD on that.
How do you get up there?
So it's going to be, once again, so this is AHQ's pick, and they also get to pick the side. And I think AHQ, Hong Kong Attitude picked defense first. They picked attack or defense first on Hanamura. I can't remember now. I believe it was attack first. It was attack first. Because they got help. They picked attack first and got fully held.
You mean HKA?
Yeah, HKA attacked first and they got fully held. Now, I'm not too sure.
Didn't expect the Torbjorn.
But realistically, like again, you keep the Pharah against the Torbjorn because that's a really good tool for taking down the turrets. In fact, Jin Kao was successfully taking down the turrets quite consistently as well. They really lost that ability after a couple of pushes. So I don't know what HQ is going to pick in terms of attacking sides. I feel like AHQ have looked like a better defending side. I think you'd agree that AHQ looked like a very strong defensive team. First hold on Hanamura. Reasonably good hold on King's Row as well. I'm kind of thinking HQ might go for the defense here again.
I really want to see them. I want to see Crappy play Torbjorn again. I bet it's kind of like, you know, me talking about the hog on the offense there, being like, you need a hog so you can hook them out of the choke and really
push
it. Yeah,
but Torb doesn't have a good setup on Dorado.
It's just how Crappy sort of talked about.
Far more likely to see a Symmetra on Dorado than you are at Torb. In fact, you're decently likely to see Symmetra, but totally unlikely to see a Torb.
I just want to see Crappy pat himself on the back, you know, because his whole team's saying don't play Torbjorn, and he's going, let me play Torbjorn. Please let me play Torbjorn.
I just want to see Crappy drop a bar.
MC Crappy in the house tonight. Well, MC Crappy in Dorado tonight. See how he obviously performs into the next match with his tail there as well.
I think he's ready to get into some real sweaty spots on the map with that kind of a sweat tail.
Well, that's right there, the tools to success right there, you know. Standing out on the Torbjorn, you need the towel. I need a towel.
You know, you got some sweaty spots to get into? Some real nerd spots out there? I don't know what I'm getting into. Look at...
I'd love to see the chat right now.
What's your take on K4's keyboard angle, though? That 45-degree keyboard
this
angle.
This is... well, I tell you what, mate. Some of us may know I do like myself the old Counter-Strike, and that is a... pristine Counter-Strike land setup right there. You know, that's how all the Counter-Strike players play. You know, makes you feel very. So I mean, this is real. If you try this at home, right?
It's like
for real. If you play a first-person shooter game and you think about your keyboard being like this, and your mouse is obviously here as well, you actually feel like you're more involved in the game. Like for real.
Sounds like placebo to me, man.
No, it's a real thing. I swear. But let's get right up into this one.
I'm in the game. I'm not in the game.
It's like virtual reality, I tell you that much. And look at that, there's going to be Jin Kao on the Pharah there. No Symmetra or any builders here from the side of AHQ though.
Yeah, the triple DPS again, this on paper should be effective against AHQ. At the same time, Blank's triple DPS may actually still just be better than Hong Kong Attitude's triple DPS. The Pharah does... Did he have a hero? He doesn't have a Pharah anymore. So Mango's actually on the Ana now, so not having the Pharah might affect Jin Kao's ability here a little bit.
Well, they're going to see how this works as they make their way up into the first choke point here. There goes Jin Kao.
Oh, that high wall on the side is important.
The predictable flanking position. Let's see if they've got anyone here listening or waiting for it. It looks like they might have
Dizzy
one player.
Dizzy is there. Dizzy's at the back of there as well. So.
Also Crappy as well. So, you know, a couple of balls to Jin Kao's face.
We're spending a long time looking at this as well.
This is absolutely riveting stuff here. Looking at this wall.
What a viewing angle.
And there it is, peeks himself over the top there, Dizzy up on the high wall, manages to eat a little bit of a rocket, but doesn't matter too much there. Does get a little bit of healing coming out from old Eddie around the back there, K4 dropping very low up in the front lines there. They do manage to find him, Dizzy with a Helix rocket. How does he get it from so far away? What an absolute shot there. Loop. Now Shyulin as well, looking to get up into the back lines, but can't really find anything. Gonna have to fall back there with a Ting dropping now as well. Jin Kao gonna be falling as well.
Wow, I didn't know Farrah could sort of somersault in the air like that. That was something else.
Those ragdoll physics coming in hot. Wow, today is definitely the meme cast. Having a blast out here today, boys.
So,
just like Jin Kao.
Jin Kao's finding it quite difficult to get over. He's really been shut down over there. Well, so Dizzy, if I'm not mistaken, Dizzy's still on that very... No, okay, he's totally not there anymore. He was on that sort of roof position. Now he's on the ground. Did a fantastic job of shutting out both K4 and Jin Kao. So just one player has managed to completely shut out two DPS.
Oh, Graviton Surge
from AHQ, locking up most of the members of Hong Kong Attitude. They're going to completely fall over here. And AHQ keeping up to the reputation, I think, with the defense.
Falling over, unlike the old man soldier, just getting all this free time up on the side, just raining death down on the side of HKA yet again. And now look at all these ultimates that AHQ still have to work with here on the defense. And we've seen this sort of hold coming out before where they just sit back, they sort of let HKA get through the choke, and once they sort of burst through there, they just get absolutely demolished there. But HKA got a little bit to work with themselves, but nothing to pair with the nano boost yet, other than a big old hammer of a Ting. They push their way in here as well. Gonna be Shyu getting up the background, see if the self-destruct finds anything. It will not. And now K4 looking to get into this one, but shooting tanks is not what he needs to do if they want to have a chance of taking this one down. Kalman though dropping down very low, needs to get some healing very quickly. There comes that nano boost, gonna be on the big man.
Shadow. Reinhardt misses, I think.
Doesn't find anything, and now they've got that transcendence as well to push through this fight. No worries for AHQ here. The Graviton as well, the counter Earth Shatter, but it doesn't matter as well. They get all grouped up there. The hammer doesn't find enough damage in the front of that, but Lazy Titan hunting them down now. A Ting gets slammed into the wall there by Eric, and AHQ just cleaning the house yet again.
That was a heartbreaker for Eric, sorry, not for Eric, for a Ting, because he landed an Earth Shatter that catches Dizzy while he was nanovised up. But none of the HKA members could actually get back there to deal with them. None of the HKA members could pick up any of the kills. So it's just alts that are just flying off the shelf for HKA, but not getting any of the results.
Well, HKA got that tactical visor of their own. See if he can get a little bit more out of this one than Dizzy got just before. But Eric getting so close to that Earthshatter yet again. Needs to just go in there, land a couple of whacks, and then he's going to be trying to get that big hammer down. But he eats the biotic grenade. It's going to be a Ting dropping very quickly as well. He's not even going to need it in this fight as well. Kalman going to be pushing them back there, doing some bicep kills indeed over the side of HKA here. And HKA can't find anything right now.
Three seconds? We're already in the overtime mark, and they're not even going to touch the card. This is Hanamura all over again. And just like Hanamura, AHQ run the exact same composition. Crappy's like, give me one more of those. Slap my hand too. It's nice and sweaty.
He's like, no, I'm not doing it while your hands are sweaty. Rub them up a bit more. See? Look. Now? This time? No.
Come back to me later. But for AHQ, they ran the exact same... that's Dizzy, actually. Dizzy's sitting right next to Crappy. But they ran the exact same composition, triple tank lineup, right at the front gates. And for Hong Kong Attitude, they can't get past three tanks. I don't know what it is. They run triple DPS, doesn't work, they swap it up, go back on the front lines, try and bust through the front door. Hello, there's another three tanks waiting for you. Every time AHQ have run this composition and held the choke, Hong Kong Attitude have no options to get past, but they should do, because it's Dorado, and you can attack from multiple angles, and still can't get through.
This is sort of why I wanted Crappy to be playing the Torbjorn there, because you can sort of see him talking to Dizzy being like, I told you so. I told you so. I told you so.
For what?
Well, because he is the caller, right?
Is he?
I'm pretty sure that he is. And it looks like a lot of this is sort of... Because they look like a completely different team now, and it looks like he sort of told Dizzy, you know, maybe where he should stand or what they're sort of going for there. And it looks like Dizzy's having to be like, yeah, all right, bro, you're all right. You're all right. I'm sorry. Something was working.
I don't know, man.
Something's working for them.
I don't know. I'll take your word for it. I can't confirm that at all. Don't take that as a fact either. There is no fact to say who is the caller for that team. I got no idea.
I'm just reading into the body language here,
man. I'll tell you who is the main caller for Hong Kong Attitude, though. It's Mango, the captain as well. And they need to figure out how to get past these three tanks. They need to figure it out big time. I'm not saying Hong Kong Attitude have a bad defense, but I think they're going to struggle to defend that card distance, because the card distance was
pitiful.
It's
pitiful.
Yeah. I'll let you say.
Savage.
It pretty much is. Like it's very close. And for Hong Kong Attitude to successfully, it's actually not super super close, but it's defendable. It's not like the worst I've ever seen, but it is still defendable, but very difficult.
Oh, AHQ, just running that sort of similar lineup yet again. Just, you know, going to be having the Soldier as their main, you know, damage dealer. Obviously trying to get Kalman supercharged up as well. Taking a look though there at the Hong Kong Attitude side, you know, very similar for them there as well. Just going to be the Genji looking to get a lot of the work done here and seeing if Jin Kao can get a bit of charge
Dizzy
up
down
himself there. Charge goes straight in, and this one is underway extremely quickly. They're not wasting any time. They want to get this one over and done with. Players
HK
from the side
coming ahead though.
Somehow they managed to push AHQ back here. Really thought that was going to come out differently.
Well, that's the thing,
the charge
is, Dizzy died straight away, so they lost so much damage on the initial push. AHQ didn't let up. They said, okay, well, Dizzy's dead, but we're committed here. We're still going to go for the push. They lose Eric in, and then they finally decide, wow, two members down. There's no way this is happening now. Come back another day.
Dizzy obviously didn't listen to Crappy enough in that exchange there.
He changes to McCree now, so going to go for an alternate push on the top side. This is what I'm talking about. On Dorado, you're not stuck on that main choke like Hanamura, so you have way more options. So this should be a winnable push for HQ, and they go through the window instead. Still a really huge tank roll on the actual point itself. K4, he's been biotic grenaded up, only gets one kill before Dizzy takes him down.
But still, the rest of the kills now coming up in the way of HKA. Even though he didn't get much mileage out of the Dragon Blade there, it doesn't matter too much now as they manage to push out the rest of these AHQ players back to the spawn. And now, for the next fight, going to have that Earthshatter, Nano Boost to work with as well, Self Destruct, Graviton Surge nearly up as well. K4 switching up to the Mei.
I don't mind this because they have to hold the choke to sort of secure this first check, but they have to do the same thing AHQ did. Nano Boost from both sides going to come up, both tanks whacking away at each other. Ting's got himself an Earth Shatter. He did use it, but can't see if he really landed on anybody.
Oh, Eric eats the biotic grenade and instead gets the charge kill and managed to turn this one around for the side of AHQ. That was absolutely insane there. When things were looking dire for him, he just comes out of nowhere. HKA though have a little bit to work with, but it's not as much as AHQ as they managed to push this one back here. Getting a lot of time on the cart now though, getting extremely close to where it should be. The biotic grenade as well going to be landing there. Shayu trying to keep this one up, will not be able to do it. He's going to drop down there as well. Mango Jai as well all over this. But he's not going to be stopping this as well. Payload moving very quickly, and that's going to be all she wrote. No Earth Shatter today.
And we are going to go to all five maps, and this time I get to feel super validated on that comment. Yes.
What do you mean? The main?
Huh?
The main?
No, all five maps.
Oh, all five maps. Oh, yeah. But, you know, totally. You were definitely right with that. But I was like,
oh,
the
main?
The main? Where was the... What, the main? The main?
Where was the main?
They didn't even need Reaper to beat the main.
Yeah, you're listening, Blake. You don't even need the Reaper to beat the Mei.
I'm sorry, I'm memeing that one out so way too much.
So that's how they got Dizzy quite early. So K4 going through the sort of window, just understanding where Dizzy was going to end up hiding from. Kills Eddie Boss as well. That's K4 pretty much single-handedly put Hong Kong Attitude ahead in that initial fight, but Hong Kong Attitude, I just don't think defensively they had what it takes to... They had what it took to... hold it out in that first checkpoint, because where AHQ held them out on was pretty impressive and a very difficult position for Hong Kong Attitude to sort of come back in. So we're starting to see a lot of these weaknesses from teams, and for AHQ and Flash Wolves against Blank in particular, it was dealing with triple DPS. Now, dealing with triple DPS on Hong Kong Attitude, so far they've been okay on that one. At the same time, Jin Kao hasn't had really that much Mercy support. He had a little bit of Mercy support on Lee Jung, where he started to really shine. But aside from that, every other time Mango's been on either Zenyatta or Anna, and Jin Kao's been kind of left in the dust a little bit. Now, when you look on the flip side, Hong Kong Attitude have severely struggled against triple tank, particularly as attack going on defense.
I mean, I could be wrong in saying this, but do you think if they had their pharmacy combo in that first attack there and didn't spend maybe 20 seconds staring at a wall when they really pressured Dizzy in that first attack, it might have been a completely different story?
Yeah, yes and no, because you having the pharmacy there would help you fly over the wall and actually contest Dizzy on the high ground. As you saw, Jin Kao struggled to contest because he was taking so much damage and not able to land enough damage back. it was Eddie Boss, I think it was on the Zenyatta, was healing Dizzy on the high ground, as well as Dizzy having his own healing pad down. So there's no way Jin Kao's going to out-damage that. And he's taking too much damage himself anyway without any healing. With the pharmacy, yes, he would have been able to better pressure that. However, taking the Mercy with the ferret on the side like that, and only having four members pushing the cart, there was no way Hong Kong Attitude were going to be able to push the cart with only four members, especially one support down. They really need... Mango on the Anna, supporting his team on the actual cart with the biotic grenades, with the additional healing from Anna, with sleep darts if necessary as well, and most importantly, the timing for the nano boost, making sure nano boost is there on time to actually get that force, get the initial punch through the front line to force them back, because that's really important to actually getting the cart through.
And I guess the other thing now that we're seeing, I guess the first, well it is the first fifth map. Is it control?
Wow.
Is it control?
No, it's hybrid again.
Is it hybrid again?
Yeah.
Wow, AHQ, because they're looking like a completely, I guess, revamped and revived team there coming out, maps 3 and 4. This is looking good for them. The reverse sweep.
It's looking a lot better as well, because that's a reverse shovel, please.
Get the brooms out, get the shovels out, go to the garden shed. It's business time for AHQ.
Yeah, it's gardening time for AHQ. As we head into map 5, it's going to be hybrid. If you've just joined us, this is the English broadcast of the Overwatch Pacific Championship. AHQ versus Hong Kong Attitude. It is 2 apiece. One more map will decide who takes this one out for the day, and it will be a hybrid map as both teams are still sort of deciding, and it's going to end up being Hong Kong Attitude's pick as they're on the home side. They're going to get to pick the map and also the starting side, but so far, for Hong Kong Attitude, I would say... don't let AHQ defend first. That's been a mistake so far.
Yeah, I think they need to set the tone, you know, with their bit of defense as well. They've sort of been walked over though.
The biggest problem is if you let AHQ defend first and they first hold you, you have to get a first hold as well. So if you defend first, even if AHQ fully cap you out, you get a chance to also do the same thing. It's going to actually be on Hollywood.
So again, this is going to work out. You know, I really want to see them run the pharmacy here. This is what I really want to see them do.
Pharmacy probably works better here because the ferret isn't required to take a flanking route. Whereas in Dorado, the ferret has to, not required, but ferret typically is good for taking that flanking route. So it's not really a requirement, but pharmacy definitely works better on Hollywood. At the same time, I think neither of these teams really play pharmacy on Hollywood. For AHQ, Symmetra Torb is probably going to come out. I'm fully expecting Symmetra Torb on defense to come out.
Props to Crappy.
But for Hong Kong Attitude, K4 on Genji on attack, Charlotte on Tracer, full dive mode, a Ting, or either a Ting or Cowman on Winsor. I think a Ting usually plays Winsor and Cowman goes the D.Va. Like a super dive composition is going to work really well for Hong Kong Attitude, particularly against turrets. So I'm sort of expecting that as well.
I guess the other thing as well is that I think the sort of lack, these matches they've lost, is it when Shaiyu is not playing...
What? Shaiyu's playing what?
Shaiyu's playing the Tracer?
You saying...
Start
the question again.
Have they lost when Shaiyu is not on Tracer?
That's kind of map dependent as well. I think Shaiyu is good on Tracer. When you're on a control, or you're on a map that's quite open spaced, putting Shaiyu on the Tracer makes a lot more sense. When you get onto maps that are much more close space, such as, you know, I guess Dorado first checkpoint, getting through the choke is a bit difficult. But once you actually get through, it's probably a little bit better, but still not the best environment for Tracer to be in. We actually did see Sholin pick up the Tracer for, I believe it was Hanamura. They did run Tracer and Genji, if I'm not mistaken. They run Tracer, Genji, and Pharah, and still really struggled to get past the triple tanks. So the thing is, for Tracer on Sholin, even if you dash past all the tanks and get to the back line, you're playing like 1v2, 1v3. The rest of your team isn't getting past those tanks, so there's still a problem.
Well, I mean, they're definitely going to need to control the verticality of the map as well, and I think that's, I guess, the one strength that HKA still look like they've got in control here. But the sort of triple tank lineup that AHQ are running with is so very hard for them to deal with.
Maybe they do need to run a Reaper. Like, all jokes aside...
Actually,
there might be an actual argument for them to start looking at Reaper, because if they are, they're struggling this much to get past Tank. Actually, the better response would probably be Hog.
Yeah.
And we saw a little bit of Jin Kao and Hog, but not really that much enough. I feel like Hog could actually be the proper answer. You will be able to get a hook in. Maybe get a hook in past the three tanks. Even if you hook in a D.Va, if you can just get the damage in as a team, it might be enough. But Hog, either Hog or Reaper could be the answer against triple tank.
I mean, I'm personally a big fan of Hog, you know, coming through. There was that, I guess, that little bit of the you know, the meta where we were just seeing Hog just come every single match. And do we see one? No, but we see a dwarfed out Crappy yet again. There's the turret. It's the man with the Torbjorn himself on the... It looks like they're going to be obviously
Crappy
on the defense.
Straight out of Overwatch. Straight out of Hollywood.
And let's see what HKA can get done here. Not going to be running that pharmacy. Jin Kao still on the Pharah though. Didn't find much support in Dorado. Let's see if he needs, if he doesn't need
they
the support.
They are letting HQ defend again, so that's very interesting. I think they're feeling quite confident about this. K4 taking the high ground is a very good start. But it'd be interesting to see how Hong Kong Attitude
actually supports. They still have to deal with Dizzy over there in the cafe.
He already outdamaged Dizzy. That's impressive.
It is impressive. Finds the headshot there. The turret goes down. Jin Kao, nice job there. But it's going to be K4 actually going to be finishing that one off. And now they get straight up into the cafe, putting a lot of pressure onto Dizzy. But they can't actually find the kill. And AHQ are going to make them pay for that one, taking them out straight away. Now Dizzy putting all that pressure onto Jin Kao. Jin Kao going to be forced back here. Dizzy finally gets taken down. Now this is going to be their moment. Without Dizzy, the side of AHQ will be struggling quite a lot here. The turret gets set up in the back. It's going to be repositioned right now. It's going to be put over on the bushes, the classic position over here. Still at level 1 though, comes up to level 2 now. The armor's actually out for the side of AHQ, so HKA going to be at a bit of a disadvantage there, especially when a team gets taken down, and a couple more members as well. Eric going to be flexing and picking up a triple.
Eric just whacked Jin Kao out of the sky, just kind of flipped the hammer on him, and this is the difficulty. Again, running a Pharah without the Mercy. The weaknesses are severely showing now. Jin Kao has to play so conservatively, he has to play so safe. He's unable to really pressure out the damage that he could. And the most difficult thing is he's finding it difficult to challenge Dizzy. As a Pharah without Mercy support, Dizzy's not concerned about Pharah at all. Dizzy's not concerned about Jin Kao whatsoever.
Well, got the tactical visor up now, so got that. A little bit of an aim assist here, so can definitely win out the duel over on the cafe there with Dizzy. They do have that ultimate advantage to work with as well, HKA. But Crappy got that molten core. You've seen him do it before. He can then go incredibly hard here on the point all by himself.
Oh, what a rocket!
And takes out Dizzy, opening this one up. Now here comes the tactical visor. AHQ
gets
good pressure though, straight away. D.Va right on top of him. A little bit early, but it doesn't really matter there. Manages to pick up a couple. D.Va going to be right up in the back lines, but without a team to keep them alive, they're going to be able to cap out the first point, I think, here, Avril.
I think Lazy Titan made a huge mistake. He should have stayed on K4 for as long as possible, or at least longer than that. The reason I said too early was because all the tanks were sort of still able to contest K4, in particular K4. So, Shailen actually did a nice little harass there. But for Lazy Titan, he immediately went up to K4 as soon as the nano visor came down. Matrix ready to go, but Lazy Titan just kind of gave up positioning. As soon as Lazy Titan ran away, K4 just went to work.
We saw this the last time actually HKA played on Hollywood. Shayu's an absolute ninja through these streets here, you know, ninjaing through the bank. But there comes the Graviton Surge, picking up a lot of these HKA members. AHQ cleaning up a pair of them, going to be forcing the rest of the team back there, managing to easily clean that fight up. But they do commit a couple of ultimates to that one. But it's actually only just the one ultimate coming out from that with the self-destruct, so not too worried about that.
Just got to message my mate here, don't mind me.
G'day mate, just watching a professional match.
Can I join your game? No.
I need the SR.
So, Dizzy still, where are we at in this game anymore? Dizzy still with the tactical visor available to go. Erican with the Earth Shatter as well. So, got to get themselves, I think AHQ had a fairly good run with the Graviton Surge, really securing that last fight for them. Earth Shatter lands on a few, wow.
Oh, but the counter sound barrier, and there's that big wooden pole in the way, going to stop that charge in its tracks. Eats a charger himself. It's also the lobby screen as well coming through there, so not too sure what's happened.
Apologies for the technical issues there. Hopefully we'll be able to get back into game very shortly, but AHQ, they actually did lose the first checkpoint defense, so HQ, a team that so far first held Hong Kong Attitude twice, losing that first checkpoint defense, and a big part of that was K4 tactical visor on the high ground, taking the taking really good positioning, and a big part of that for me was AHQ not pressuring K4 down. They, again, Lazy Titan had the positioning, he had the matrix, but he sort of lost that, he lost that early battle and just left.
That was going to be my question there, is did they actually, was there matrix left, or?
I don't know, maybe there wasn't enough matrix left either, which is a big issue, but even if there wasn't, Lazy Titan should have just taken one for the team and tanked the whole tactical visor.
Just put the big mech in his face,
just
you know?
Literally put the mech in his face, tank the tac visor. Sure, you'll lose your life, but the rest of your team doesn't die, and that's what's important.
You're not even going to lose your life, you're losing your robot, you know?
Yeah, I mean...
Still get a second chance, you know? I've seen some big D.Va pistol plays, you know? It could always happen.
Basically, you're just trying to buy as much time for your team as well. You're just playing... you're playing harass and also just playing obstruction. You're just there to... You're there to prevent as much... It's damage control is what I'm trying to say. You're there to prevent as much damage output from the tac visor double ultimate combo as much as possible. And for a single hero that doesn't commit an ultimate to cancel out two ultimates, that's a big deal.
Yeah, do some damage and take some damage while you receive some damage and block some damage. Damage upon damage on damage.
More damage.
Looks like the player should be
Why
getting ready.
Why did we lose? not enough damage.
And then... More on our expert analysis later on. The team with more kills gets the win. But it looks like these players are going to be getting ready. Or are they going? Is it the sub?
A few questions.
Is it the substitute?
No, that's the coach. That is the, if I'm not mistaken, just confirm that. Just taking a look at all their beautiful faces. Coach J. JFPS Life, if I'm not mistaken there.
JFPS Life?
Yeah, that's the. Did you not watch the interview? He came up in that.
What, his whole name?
What, his tag? His...
Is it? I thought it was just J.
Oh, it is J. It is also JFPS Life. That's what came up in the
interview. Oh, okay. So some of these guys, you know, it's the abbreviated version.
Yeah, just like K4 is actually K for real. Yeah. And Mango is Mango Jai is Mango Long Jai from Bongmi. Like they've had longer names before. They sort of shortened them all down a little bit. Still like to call them K for real.
Yeah.
Kind of missed that, actually.
Yeah, a couple of times there, you know, K is... For real this game, K is not for real this game. Beautiful stuff, really.
Yeah, so it looks like the game so far has just been paused while they're sorting out a couple of issues.
Oh, thank goodness, it's not a restart.
Well, I mean, you got a pause feature in the game, let's just use it. I think if you're Hong Kong Attitude right now, you don't want to restart. You're like, yeah, we got past that first checkpoint because it's been a toughie. So yeah, they're just waiting on that pause currently. What do you think about the team so far? Now, after watching, we're onto the second checkpoint. AHQ are still defending, but Hong Kong Attitude look like they got a little bit more pacing in their steps for this map around.
Yeah, well, I mean, it is their pick, is it not? And we've sort of seen them be very, very good on Hollywood before. They definitely have a full understanding as to how the map should be played. And, you know, Shayu, I think, is a definite standout player, especially now that they're into the streets phase of this. And I think that's really going to work out in their favor. And I mentioned it before, you know, when Shayu's on the Tracer, it really looks like HKA, you know, come into their element.
Okay. Well, while the teams are sorting out the issue and the game is still paused, we're just going to take a slight moment to have a little bit of a breather. And when we come back, the map number 5 will continue. So see you soon. Welcome back and thank you very much for your patience as we get prepared again for map number 5, Hong Kong Attitude versus AHQ. You're joining the English broadcast of the Overwatch Pacific Championship with myself, Avril, and Easy. Now, we've just had a few technical problems with the players over in Taiwan. They are going to be restarting the map. It is still Hollywood.
That, yes, indeed it is. I don't think they would have changed the map at this point, I don't think.
You have an issue. You restart the map, but you don't...
We'll change the map as well.
Just start a whole new series, guys. That best of 5 score from number 1.
I didn't look like how the look Hollywood was, boys. Just pause the game. Restart the game.
New map, please.
Oh, yeah, we're getting back into Hollywood. Obviously, things are back on track. Hopefully things are going to be...
Let's consider, though, the results so far. It is 2-2. AHQ, very strong defense. AHQ now... Understand probably, but I think they were the ones that may have had the technical issues on their side, but taking that aside, they did lose a checkpoint, whether that was issues or not.
Yeah, but why did they lose the checkpoint? You know, that's the...
I feel like my points still do stand based on what happened, which is, you know, HQ kind of allowed HKA to get that upper high ground advantage, didn't really contest K4 anymore. Let's see if they make that mistake again or whether they're going to do something about it.
Well, a little bit more damage taken onto K4 there as he tries to get his way through the archway there, manages to also get back up on the high ground yet again. Now, the issue here obviously was Lazy Titan, you know, not contesting K4 when he did hit that tactical visor.
it looks like this time he might be able to get the turret down in the same sort of time frame they did in the first sort of exchanges we saw here. All that pressure going straight onto Dizzy again over in the cafe. Crappy though, where's the turret going to be set up? Nowhere to be found just yet. Puts it on the backward steps like we'd seen just before as well. A lot of pressure. Jinkao eats a shot to the face there, gets taken out. And now AHQ managing to find a couple of kills to open it up here.
Yeah, well, K4's still uncontested. Like I said, this was a problem for HQ last time. They still haven't really dealt with this. Here comes Lazy Tiny, pushes them off immediately. That's what they were looking for. And Dizzy picks up the kill in response. The only sort of consolation prize for Hong Kong Attitude is they did pick up Lazy Titan's mech, but so far haven't been able to break this defense, certainly not in the manner that they did last time.
Well, Dizzy actually ahead on the nano visor, on the nano booster, on the nano visor this time, because you see the nano booster is actually
tactical
up there.
Tactical sword.
The tactical sword, the visor of the nano with the boostage. Bong me, man, bong him. You know, give him the nano boost.
Well, he's,
you know,
definitely got the boost. He has a pulse bomb as well, and Dizzy's going to eat that all up. Crappy goes down to Jin Kao, and this could be the attack the Hong Kong Attitude were looking for before any boss. Still hiding in the stairs, and Sholin's going to try and chase him down. That's the tactical visor taking out Eric as well. HQ get a couple of kills on an exchange. Will it be enough kills to save him?
You know, Dizzy only gets the tactical visor up now. Graviton Surge coming in there. The sound barrier keeping them alive ever so slightly, but it looks like Lazy Titan should be able to push him off here. And it looks like somehow, some way, they've managed to turn this one back around. Great counterplay coming out there from the side of AHQ. That Graviton Surge saving lives as well.
Yeah, Hong Kong Attitude, yeah, they used a lot to get in there, tactical wise from K4 as well. They did a lot of damage, they got the majority of the kills. But Lazy Titan coming back in, able to contest. Here comes round number two. It's going to be Nano Boost committed on, believe, a Ting. Pulse Bomb, sorry, this is actually the self-destruct. Not going to pick up anyone just yet. Ting getting cleaned up by Crappy's turret. So far, HQ still holding onto this one as HKA get routed, and they're going to have to fall back, regroup, and reattempt another push.
And HKA do indeed get routed and pushed off this one. Sorry, HK. Did you mean routed?
Yeah, routed. That's a thing. That's okay. A real thing.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean. I know what you mean. Oh, goodness me. Not ready just yet.
Do you need another break? Would you like another break?
Shaiyu getting up in the back line here again. Got another pulse bomb to work with. That's what he's looking for. Jinkao going to need to make this barrage, though, go to work. K4 got another tactical visor as well. Still no
Anubus
yet. Oh my god, he manages to find it right there. But the shield saving him. Very good stuff there. The barrage taking the turret down. But is it enough there? Because he eats a helix rocket. So Jinkao going to be shot down out of the sky. Great stuff as well. Now Shaiyu going to be pushed out of this one. He'll pay with his life as well. And HKA, not much left in the toolbox here for them to push onto this point. A Ting will retreat there as well, and the rest of the team should follow here. But the Nano Boost coming back in to keep him alive here. Looking to get a little bit of damage done with this one.
Primal Rage.
Jump in, and this is all go again. Mango Jai, though, being pushed up at the back by Lazy Titan.
K4
not being contested up
there. Grab, though, whoa, picks up both of those players, and Mango as well. Cowman completely shutting down all the damage from Hong Kong Attitude. A Ting gets shut down as well. And you said, look, you know, tools in the toolbox, maybe it's time to bring out the hammer.
And definitely there, that Graviton Surge, the positioning on that, picking up those two players up there on the high ground, pulling Jinkao into that was very, very good.
7 seconds.
And now Jinkao switching to the D.Va, 5 seconds left now on the clock. They need to get back onto this one. Jinkao right up on the point there as well. Shaiyu running straight into Eric's face there, but not getting anything done just yet. CQB gonna have that sound barrier, which is about to drop right now. Earthshatter connecting
Molten
with three.
Core.
Let's see what they can find there with that. The Molten Core Crappy's right up in their face, just going to work as well. Dizzy uncontested up the back. Overtime ticking down, and they do keep this one alive. HKA, but they're slowly dwindling off the point, and AHQ gonna hold this at point number one.
And once again, AHQ, the defense on the first checkpoint is so, so solid. Now it's all smiles all around at the AHQ camp. This is what they were looking for. Crappy's got his finger out. One more attack, and it's gonna be it.
See, he's the master. I told you this.
It's that, or are you saying,
I told
Dizzy,
you so.
What is going on?
He's Dizzy. Saying, I told you so. My Torbjorn, best Torbjorn.
Dizzy's looking the other direction, like, stop waving at me. Get that finger out of my face. You're sweaty.
Look at what he's doing. What is that? Keep it doing. Keep it rolling.
Okay, so on one hand, though, when you really consider what happened before the restart, you got to feel slightly, a little bit robbed of your Hong Kong Attitude. You did get that initial cap through. At the same time, you know, AHQ, if they had a couple of problems, it seems like everything's working out for them once again in Hong Kong Attitude. Any sort of difficulties they've had with their attack, specifically against the first checkpoint hold, that's repeated itself three times.
But at the same time there as well, if you're Hong Kong Attitude, you might feel, I guess, a little bit robbed in this situation. But AHQ, you know, if the match went on from where it was...
They probably felt a bit robbed
as
well.
If the technical issue was on their side and they did play with maybe a player down or something along those lines, they're going to be feeling extremely unhappy about that one as well. So, I mean, starting fresh, I think, is obviously the best option for both teams there. You know, if HKR were as good as they were on the first attack, they should have been able to do it again.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like they did attempt to do that, but this time around, you know, Lazy Titan definitely contesting K4 on the top ground. And even the Cowman with the Graviton Surge, securing Dizzy, Jin Cow, and then Mango as well. That is exactly what HQ needed to secure that defense. I mean, the times when it really mattered to really come back and contest not only K4, but then Jin Cow simultaneously, being able to do that on the HQ side is incredible. Now, for Hong Kong Attitude, they had a couple of moments. They had a moment where it looked like they were about to cap out, but Lazy Titan once again coming back in, followed by Crappy, just holding out in time.
Oh, well, they've delved into the AHQ strat book here as well, going to be hitting CQB on that Torbjorn, seeing if it can work out as well for them as it did for the side of AHQ here. Now, Lazy Titan getting right up into the stairwell, not giving any of this high ground any room for HKA to get up onto that high ground over the side there. They need to deal with this turret first before they sort of move in there. CQB almost dropping down in that fight. Their Cowman dropping disastrously low.
He's got to
Dizzy in the back lines. They pounce on him very, very quickly, but he's got Lucio there to back him up. Good job there by Crappy.
Crappy sort of there to join. How did Crappy get there? He sort of just skated around, and CQB's got he's in a lot of trouble. Discord all doing work, and AHQ are cleaning this one up. Are HQ going to clap this one out?
And the first fight, they waste no time at all. They get right up into the back lines there. Lucio and Tracer dealing with these very squishy heroes up in the back line. The point is capping down right now. Can HKA get themselves back onto the point? It looks like there's nothing they can do.
Oh, wow, a double pulse bomb to clean it out. AHQ, they get the reverse sweep. It's going to be 3-2. What a cleanup.
Unbelievable stuff there. I mean, that is actually the first reverse sweep we've seen here in the tournament. Obviously, the first five-game series.
Naturally.
Well, just like, they're not changing maps. It's going to still be on Hollywood. That's also the first reverse sweep.
The only reverse sweep and the only best of five series we've seen so far. I don't think, I think that the math checks out.
I'll have you know that this was a reverse. Yeah, I'm going to be hearing about that one later on. That's for sure.
We're here all night. No. this HQ again, like their ability to defend the first checkpoint is incredibly good. Now, something to note is against Flash Wolves, we actually saw Flash Wolves actually did an extreme. Obviously, Flash Wolves won 3-0, but Flash Wolves did not struggle that hard to get past a first checkpoint defense. In fact, I keep going back to Volskaya, but HQ have a Torbjorn strat for that as well. Flash Wolves completely dismantled now for Hong Kong Attitude. They severely struggled for different reasons as well on Hanamura and also on Dorado. They failed to get past the first sort of the gate, that opening gate, getting past the triple tank. Now coming onto Hollywood, different sort of scenario. Yeah, the tanks are still there, the turret is there, but they're no longer stuck in that chokehold, and yet still they failed to get past.
I mean, it was a really nice piece of, I guess, harassment there. You know, Tracer up in the back lines doing a lot of work there. You know, committing a lot of those HKA members, you know, back into the cafe. And then Cowman was just there to sort of just clean it up. The way that AHQ sort of, I guess, you know, can read into these situations just slightly, I'd say, better than HKA can on the fly.
Just, you know, their ability to get their plays. Like, I was very surprised that Dizzy on the Tracer got in behind the cafe, but Crappy was there too. I was like, who's Lucio? Is that? Is that HQ's Lucio? Because... how did he get there? There's a blink.
Yeah, I was thinking that the Lucio was going to destroy Dizzy there for a second, and then I was like, wait, that's his teammate.
I thought that was the other team. Then I was like, wait, they're not running. I got so confused for a second. Then I was like, okay, so Crappy's there. So realistically, HQ, they managed to get multiple players into positions where suddenly the focus fire and holding the front line, particularly protecting the turret for ongoing attitude, no longer really works out because they're not able to. They're not able to defend both an attack coming from the cafe within the cafe and then also from the front lines as well, and then potentially also from the high ground in that middle section, that middle roof. So Hong Kong Attitude just sort of got out positioned and didn't know where to look towards the end.
And I mean, I may be putting, I guess, you know, talking, I guess, rubbish here, but I mean, CQB going on the Torbjorn, it's something that, you know, Crappy talked about in his interview, that he feels very confident on his Torbjorn, and it's something that he really wants to run, and he wants his team, you know, to let him run it. And we saw there when they played defense why he's, you know, such a good Torbjörn. He's very good at sort of changing his turret location, you know, obviously hitting shots himself as well, you know, his armor throwing as well. Even that's a skill in itself, to be quite honest, to throw the armor, make it land on the fly in the mid fight. But CQB getting absolutely nothing done, I feel, on his Torbjörn.
He got killed pretty quickly. Something else I got to note is inside that sort of mess and the little bit of a that hectic moment inside the bottom area of the cafe, CQB got a Discord orb put on him very quickly that Dizzy took full advantage of. Cowman was actually in the middle of that. But the fact that Eddie Boss was able to find the angles to land the Discords inside the cafe among all of the mess in there. Not only did he land the Discord orb onto CQB, who got taken down, immediately puts the Discord orb onto, I can't remember, but the next player directly in there. So the line of sight sort of required means that for HQ, they need to have such good positioning and such good area control within the actual cap point itself for Zenyatta to have that actual line of sight to get the Discord orbs in.
That was the other thing. You know, it seems like HK, I guess, had a little bit of lack of communication there. A lot of those players sort of fell back, you know, into the cafe to sort of assist their teammates. Mm. And you've got the players like the Zenyatta, you know, getting to just do complete free work, you know, on the outside while they're standing on the point there. But then they're automatically all walking in towards the Genji and the Tracer and, you know, crappy yeah. as well on the Lucio. And so I just think the decision making and, you know, the positioning coming out from AHQ, you know, just was consistently getting better throughout all those matchups there. You know, HKA had a very strong performance on control, very good control team, you know, very strong mechanically skilled team. But when it comes to these sort of structured defenses, like I sort of talked as we got into these maps, that's definitely where AHQ shine.
At the same time, though, looking at, I believe it was King's Row that Hong Kong Attitude won as well. As much as HQ are great on their defense, certainly on King's Row, it just wasn't the case. Hong Kong Attitude were able to break through eventually as well. So I was trying to remember what that came off the back. Was that the quadruple self-destruct
that
secured
that
one?
Yeah, that was the game.
So that was the quadruple self-destruct secured that first... that first attack as well. But let's even take a look at the time bank, because time bank Hong Kong Attitude pushed all the way through all three checkpoints and got a full cap out. Now, against a team with supposedly good defense, that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen against a team with extremely good defense. So whatever HQ has, it's lacking on King's Row.
And I mean, maybe is it the map, or is it, I guess, maybe the playstyles of some of these teams? Because, you know, Blank, we go back to this whole, like, Blank's, you know, being weak on King's Row. They're not so weak on King's Row anymore. But what is really the issue, you feel? You know, is it because of, I guess, maybe the routes that you take?
I think AHQ got a little bit flustered in the time bank, and they sort of lost a lot of patience there. Like I said, the really what they should have been looking to do is group up and take slower fights to build up to a fight where they know they can just win in one defense, rather than just keep throwing members at the cart over and over and over and over. Just sort of sprinkling their members onto the cart, but it's just, they're trickling members, they're constantly feeding ults onto Hong Kong Attitude, and you have to understand that as a defender, you're not actually the team under pressure. The attackers are under pressure because they're into overtime. They can't get off the cart, they have to continually push. They don't have time to reset for fights. This is it. They have one push left to go, and they have to get it all the way. So they're extremely pressured, and HQ, they need to be a lot more reserved.
Well, big pressure now with the interview coming up, and who is it going to be?
Dizzy. 好，要先请问Dizzy第一个问题，就是在第四张地图的时候，多拉多开局的平台是怎么上去的？是不是教大家一下？
那个平台是用小美，然后再配那个76火箭跳跳上去的。哦，因为你们在多拉多又遇到法拉这个角色嘛，因为上次你们对上 Blank
之后啊，在对战过程当中有一些状况，那是不是在那场比赛之后有做一些改善呢？我们回去检讨之后就是改善自己的站位吧，就比较多小心法拉位置，对，然后就比较针对法拉打，就减少自己的失误这样子打。
这也是我们太平洋职业锦标赛的第一次打满了5场比赛，有没有感觉就是说赏给了HK第一场就败仗，滋味怎么样？跟大家分享一下。
就也没什么滋味，就只是打得很辛苦啊。
好，谢谢弟弟接受我们的访问，谢谢谢谢。
好，接下来 the first question was regarding how they get the Soldier 76 onto that high ledge onto Rider defense, and Jesse was saying that they use the May as well as a rocket jump off the May wall to actually jump onto there. Second question was regarding obviously they play blank on Dorado as well. What did they sort of change up on Dorado going into preparation against Hong Kong Attitude? And Dizzy mentioned that they looked out for Fair a lot more. So one of the strategies that blank used, or they used Trill on the Fair over the back roof, over the back sort of archway, that flank that we sort of already know about. And Dizzy was saying he watched out for that a lot more. In fact, he did a great job watching out for that because he actually shot down, he denied Jin Kao quite a lot. And the last question was finally, this is the first best of five we've seen in the OPC. What are your sort of thoughts on that? And, you know, what did you feel playing it? And he said it was a very tough series, a very very grueling series to sort of pay through, and definitely took a lot of effort for them to complete. So,
well, I mean,
that's dizzy.
It's going to play, I guess, into two different things. So now they're obviously feeling warm, you know, coming up against Sun Sister next. So AHQ are playing back to back. But the other thing is as well, you know, have they tired themselves out? You know, is Sun Sister going to be able to take anything away from them there? Because we saw with Flash Wolves last night, you know, when they played Marchie afterwards, I don't know if it was because they were feeling maybe a little bit let down on themselves or if they were just a little bit tired out, you know, from that four-game series there. But, you know, Marchie managed to pick up that first control map. You know, after that, Flash Wolves, you know, recompose themselves and recover and sort of, you know, establish that dominance. But, you know, coming up against these other teams, you know, you can't count them out, you know, coming up against AHQ after they've just played a five-game series.
Yeah, I think Sun Sister is still going to have a very difficult game. And for HQ, maybe a big long break, not a big long break, but definitely a short intermission between now and their next match is exactly what they need. Certainly they'll need to swap sides and setting as well. HQ are then going to be on the home side going up against Sun Sister on the away side for match number two of the Overwatch Pacific Championship when we come back.